You are now entering Maximum Driftcast, the only drifting podcast hosted by a Spanish soccer mom, a 30-year-old silver-haired fox going on 60, and finally, a 200-pound bowl of spaghetti with chimichanga arms.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to another episode of Maximum Driftcast. I'm here with the boys, right?
Hey, guys. It's me, Corey, and I'm here with the boys.
Hey, Paco. Who are you here with?
I'm with the boys.
Yeah! And today we're actually going to do an all-facts Driftcast. It's called the Drift Facts, really. Yep. So we got a bunch of insider info about Formula Drift, and we just cannot wait to tell you guys. So first of all, I learned last week that they're getting rid of every round but FD Orlando, and it's going to be 8 rounds of FD Orlando.
Yep.
8 weekends in a row, all in July.
Yeah, they're trying to time it when it rains a lot.
It's all really wet.
They're looking, they talked to the weather station out there, and the weather station said if you hit mid-July the whole month, you can get 8 rounds in, and it's a 90% chance of participation.
Yep. And also, so this coming along with that fact, which is really nuts, is they said that just to kind of even out the playing field, it's going to be LSs only.
Yep.
But here's the bullshit, though, is that they let Mad Mike have a rotary still. So it's just going to be Mad Mike.
But it's going to be an 8 rotor.
It's going to be the 8 rotor. That was the rule, because you have to have as many rotors as pistons. And it's just, I hate Formula Drift because they keep on doing this to us.
Well, but it's also, you know, with their new tire sponsors, what they want to do is make people just wear use one set of tires during the entire race.
Right.
And that's why they're going for the wet paving.
So. Right. So the that is true. The tire that you start the weekend with is what you have to finish the weekend with.
Oh, was it just the weekend? Because I thought it was the whole
season?
Month. Yeah.
Oh, we need to get that clarified. I'm not really sure, but
I think I heard something about, like, if you win, you are allowed to get a fresh set of tires. So
that's a good point. Now it balances out. At first I was really confused, but it really balances out. If you win, only the winner gets a new set of tires.
Yeah,
that is cool.
And that set of tires is paid by the second place.
And then obviously the biggest bomb drop that we have, and this is the one that's really blowing everyone's minds, is I heard that last year's champion is going to be bowing out of Formula Drift entirely to focus on professional rollerblading.
Well, it's becoming a big thing.
You guys have been pretty on point with your guys' facts here.
We happen to have an extra seat, so why don't you get in here and let people listen to you?
Hey, I was just reading.
You guys, expecting me for anything?
Well, no, I was actually.
You guys
I was.
Know? The podcast handled.
Well, it's funny. Last week, Ryan Lontaine left his notes here, and we were just reading through them. Right
Ryan,
is that what it is?
Yeah,
is that what I've been hearing for the past minute and a half?
Look, it's right here. It has birds on it. So this is Ryan Lontaine's notebook with drift facts.
We found Ryan Lontaine's notebook, and what else does that say?
It says Cape Cod, Alabama Slammer, and Paloma.
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 So wait, those are the new locations for next year?
That must be. Yeah.
Well, there's a couple places. Yep. Well, it looks like they've already done the Moscow Mules and Tim Collins.
Next. That's my favorite one.
Yep. So we just got the Kamikaze and Sangria next. So
perfect.
Do you know what, boys? Case closed.
Case closed. Form of the Drift 2017 locked up. So
that must be it. Tim Collins is winning the championship.
Yeah,
Tim Collins or Phil Collins?
Phil Collins.
Phil Collins' brother, Tim Collins, just won the championship. Boys.
I can feel it coming in the air.
Yeah. What did you just say?
Paco,
what?
Come on.
Paco, oh, this is a fucking Paco. Podcast for kids, dude.
That's how the song goes, isn't it?
I don't know, man.
I can feel it coming in the air tonight.
Dude, that's not it. Keep going.
Keep going.
I just made it
I
up.
Hope it goes right into Spanish the second verse.
Since apparently we're kind of like doing alternative facts.
We already did that. That was 2 weeks ago.
That was the alternative.
These are real facts. Chris can corroborate. Because for those that didn't understand anything that just went on, welcome to the show.
Welcome to Maximum Driftcast, the only drift podcast where this is our third Mimosa Sunday.
Yeah. Yep, this is so we've got a Maximum
and
Mimosa.
And coincidentally, that's how many championships Chris won.
Yep.
Oh, that's oddly timed.
So that's how we schedule it. We've been waiting all year
for
this.
Why don't we have a Mimosa, Chris, here?
Yep. Oh, look at that.
I made one for you.
Oh, 2013. And that's interesting.
Yeah, so what's the relevance of that year? That was a good year for you,
that's
right?
That's when Chris almost won his 4th championship.
That's right. Corey, did you get this class for me?
Yeah, I did. I felt so fucking bad.
Yeah.
I felt so bad. It's like, here, dude,
this is what
you'd be drinking out of if you would have won. So just keep this.
So that
completely fixes the whole situation.
Well,
which the situation is, for those that are not aware, is when Corey qualified 33rd, and if he would have qualified 32nd, there would have been a much much higher chance of Forsberg winning the championship.
He would have won.
There would have been a different outcome.
Well, here's the other thing, too, is if I didn't lose the ESSA in Atlanta that year, he would have won, too. Mm-hmm. So there's so two.
It's all Corey's fault.
A lot of coulda, woulda, shouldas.
Well, yeah, it was one of those things. I'm like, I'm really going to fuck him in Atlanta. And I purposely lost. And then I got to Irwin, and I was like, I don't know if that was enough. I'm going to try it again.
Cheers to that, Corey. Well, where's yours?
Here's my little shooter, just emptied.
Looks great.
I'll tell you what, the nice thing about that is once we – can I get a Sharpie? Do we have a Sharpie, guys?
Uh-oh.
I need a Sharpie. Steph, do we have a Sharpie? Forsberg, can I see your glass real quick?
You got it.
Uh-oh. Hold on a second. The reason I got this glass is because look what we'll do. We'll turn that into an 18.
Wait, so what the hell is
so
that?
So that means you're going to win this year too, but I can't make it a 7. So,
Chris.
I better start stocking up my edible arrangements.
Chris has been a long-time listener, first-time caller on our show. And he has long-time corrected us because we often get a lot of things
somewhat
mistaken.
I could try and correct your grammar right now.
Yeah, I was about to say.
Why four would you have been saying? Fix.
We've been hanging out with Paco too much because he fucks us up.
It's just
so
contagious.
Bad.
Ruined.
Yeah, I can see that.
But yeah, so Chris is here in town because he just couldn't stand listening to the show anymore, and he's had to fix the thing that we're doing.
Yeah, I mean it's it's been painful to just sit.
Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. It's been tough to listen to driving around, running errands out in California. And just had to come out here and just put my time in and get the facts straight.
Well, we're thankful that you are here to fix our show.
We're really looking forward to it.
We've been missing on your phone calls. You know, like you used to call us on the cell
phone. Okay.
And correct our previous mistakes, but apparently
I ran out of minutes from calling you guys so often. So
the cricket minutes. Yeah.
Well, here's the thing: is that I know that you have obviously a huge drift program, and you use Boost Mobile for your entire team.
Absolutely.
You actually don't even use walkies for your team. It's just
where that black and orange comes from.
You just have burner Boost Mobile phones every event.
Hey guys.
Can we get a salute for
2018?
2018 that, and 17. 18. There we go. Cheers, boys.
Is that when you sneeze?
Oh, I just spilt again on Paco's lap. What the
Oh, can we? I think we should then bring up the real reason why Chris
real
came.
Reason.
Real reason. Right? Real reason it. So Chris came here
To watch Bob Ross.
To do a very, because it's something that I know you guys have been waiting for a very long time. It's very exciting. Chris drove all the way from California to my humble abode here.
Mm-hmm.
And
to sit in on this podcast.
Well, I was going to say that that is much bigger than that.
Uh-oh.
It's a lot bigger than that. And it was, do you want to say it?
Dare do you say it?
Well, no, I think I'll do it. So what happened? Okay, I know you guys have been waiting.
I got the Bill Nye reference.
Well, it's what you guys have been waiting to hear for a long time.
Okay.
I've been waiting to, I can't wait to say this because it's been years that I've wanted to say that this thing is happening.
Oh, my God, just say it, Sam.
I beat Chris at darts last night.
Oh, my God.
We went to the bar.
Yeah.
And I beat Chris Forsberg at darts. He might be the most winningest drifter in Formula Drift history, but I beat him at darts.
Let's just say that you are a closer.
Sam, is that true?
How's that?
Yeah.
It was just funny you say that because I'm naked right now.
Yeah.
Wow. from the waist down. You can't really tell if you're watching this show. I'm only Donald Ducking. Oh, you mean closer, like closing deals.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
No, it's actually, so aside from beating him at darts, there's another thing.
Okay, let's hear it. I'm ready.
I beat him at pool.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. You guys are crazy.
It might have been the longest game of pool I've ever played.
The game did go on for about 2 hours, and it went in my favor, then his favor. And let me just say that there was about a scratch on every single time the ball was hit. And a couple times we may have just straight up missed the cue ball.
Yeah, it was amazing to watch.
Looks like you guys are very proficient at pool.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah. Oh, and by the way, we're fixing my S14.
Oh, that's it.
Wow. Yeah. I like the pool story better.
Yeah. Yeah, let's get back to that. So we're at the
bar.
You
guys were using Sharpie markers instead of pool sticks, just kind of giving a little.
Probably would have done better.
All right. Well, should we move on to new things?
Sure.
Wait. So let me say, so the whole fixing your car was part of a drunk conversation. You know what? I'm just going to fix your piece of shit.
Wait.
Paco, I mean, who's the redneck?
Paco. While I'm here, yeah. I guess I'll just drag this thing back.
But Paco, so first of all, this
apparently
Chris,
that's what I said. Like
Paco, who were you mimicking?
Paco, let me hear your best Forsberg impression.
Drunk
Forsberg? Yeah, I've heard a lot of pro drifters.
Yeah,
from
let's
Paco.
Hear.
Let's hear me.
Let's hear Vons.
No, this is
Forsberg. We all know.
Yeah, I had a stroke. Sorry, guys. Forsberg's.
Okay, Forsberg?
Yeah.
Yeah. Fire it up.
All right.
We're here. We're live.
Okay,
that's
Vaughn.
That's Vaughn.
Still Vaughn.
I sound like Vaughn.
All my impersonations sound like Vaughn.
Oh my God, I sound like Jan.
All right, Paco, you have one more chance. Get Forsberg right.
Supposed to get Forsberg?
Yep.
Let me see if I can do this. Hello, it's Chris Forsberg. We are. Shit.
I just sound like Paco.
No, that was pretty good.
Hold on, let's keep going, Paco. Tell us what you're doing.
It's Chris Forsberg. We are in another episode of Drift Garage.
Okay.
This time, we're bringing a car from this guy known as the Drift Idiot.
Wow.
Stop, you're doing too many spoilers for the show.
Oh, my God.
You're spoiling the show. No one's going to watch it now.
Yeah. I don't know.
No one's even going to watch Drift Crash now.
Right. And Chris usually stands with his hands behind his back. He doesn't do the hand thing.
No, he does a...
You kind of do
I've adapted the Vaughn.
Yep.
All right, also, guys. You adopted the Vaughn?
Yeah, I adopted the Vaughn.
All right, guys, so here we are. You touch the fingertips. And when you touch the fingertips, you just get immense amount of power.
Here's the church. Here's the steeple. Open it up.
And there's people
all
smoking cigarettes and drinking beer inside of it.
What kind of church did you go to as a kid?
I want to go to that church.
Yeah, wait a second.
So Paco then just revealed the next little tidbit of that situation is we're going to put this car in Drift Garage.
That's right.
So there is a show that was the first professional production you could say I was ever a part of a couple of years ago, four years ago.
Is that true?
Yep.
Wow, I didn't know that.
Yeah, first time I really shot professionally.
Wow,
well,
you really lied to us on your resume.
Sure did. Was a little ditty of a show called Drift Garage, and we built an S13 in season one. Mm-hmm. We took a really shitty Tony Angelo's shop had. Do you know whose car was that? Do you know?
It was Andy's.
And it was actually Andy's car from the start.
But he left it at Tony's shop to rock.
He broke it.
Yeah, he broke it.
It was the frame was fucked up. It was rusty as hell.
Oh yeah, he crashed it into a wall.
And had a blown KA. And then we picked that car up and we turbocharged it. We replaced the motor. We did a bunch of sweet stuff to it, and then broke it again a little bit, and then fixed it, and then we filmed it.
Yeah, a little bit of a bad tune blew the motor, so I had to throw a head gasket in there behind the scenes and get it back going. But yeah, that was Andy's car. We built that in season one. Everyone loved it. Drift Garage was a good hit, and then we started to go, a couple different directions, and now season four, we're just bringing it back to home.
Yep,
going back to crappy 240s with stupid directors that blow them up and don't know why. And we're gonna fix them.
Is Professor Martin Issel making a comeback?
I would love for a cameo, but I don't think that people want a full season of him again. Even though I was a fan, I think Chris was hesitant to do it. And in hindsight, it was kind of like, well, I look like an asshole, but
yeah.
Well, what you should
goober.
You guys should do a documentary on Martin Issel?
Issel.
Martin. You should do a documentary on him and see where he's at now in his life.
Yeah.
Well,
he's working at a body shop.
I was gonna say, Corey, what if you have a cameo in the show? Maybe that you're Martin Issel, who has not aged well at all.
No. I'm a wash up body tech at Mako. I just sand and primer cars all day.
Because the missile car scene is now over. The missile crisis is over because you have to have a nice car. So you were out of a job.
Thanks to all the people DMing Paco over here.
Yep. Yep.
Yeah. Getting all the body
sliding
kits.
Yeah.
How many emails do you get? How many messages do you get off of that for reals?
There's a lot of people like in a funny way.
I told everyone to email Paco and send him a CMG.
No, I get a lot, especially on Instagram. I get a lot of like, "Hi, Maximum Driftcast told me to ask for a free kit."
You're welcome for that.
Man, it's that easy. I need to do that.
Yep. Well, Gucci did it and it worked.
Yep.
Well, he asked me in person.
Oh, that's fucked up.
So he didn't have to slide into the DM. I tried to slide into his DM first.
Mm. Yep.
And wait, what do you mean when you say slide into his DM?
I thought you were a cool kid, Sam.
His direct manhole?
No, he said BM.
His brown
muscle.
God damn. Okay. Moving on. Back to the car thing. Yeah, so I've been making tons of videos for the past few years, and you guys have been really supportive in saying, stop making all this shit and fix your car.
Mm-hmm.
So thank you for all the support you guys have given over the years.
Yep.
And it's finally happening. And I can't wait for you to be disappointed in this as well.
Yep, absolutely.
That's awesome.
We're going to make sure they're 3 minutes long, and we're not going to show any tech, and it's just going to be, another new product, and we'll see how it goes.
Just going to be fluids, I think. We're just going to put a bunch of fluids.
We're just going to put a bunch of Valvoline.
Valvolines.
Just all over the car. Just dump Valvoline on everything.
Yep.
I mean, how do you think we fix these cars?
I was going to say, it's just going to be just dumping oil over the car and then like a trick shot of like Mr. Clean, ding, like a bunch of glitter occurs and it's like a fully built car.
Or I wish we would go to like an El Camino and you dump more oil on it, then it turns into your car, but it should at least transfer once to a shitty car and then...
Hold on, you should tell your friends at Donut, Chris, that a good video idea is to fill an El Camino bed with Valvoline. And then you and Turk wrestle.
We'll go oil wrestling. Yeah. Yeah, that'd be good.
You should have really announced your partnership that way, I think.
Yeah, that'd probably be the best way to do it. And we all know that people love our Valvoline commercials.
Yeah,
and,
for sure.
And in any way that Turk and I can get more connected.
Like docking.
Oh, my.
But Donut is actually going to be part of the production team on this, and we are going to be filming it. I don't want to say we're filming it, but... because maybe it's
going to
be on the
moon. Yeah, we use actually digital recording. We don't film anything.
Yeah, it's all green screen. You've seen Star Wars Episode 1. Better than that movie. It's going to be better than that.
It's going to be loosely based on Episode 1. It's going to green screen a broken car in the background, pour some oil on it, turns into a new car.
New locations, new cars.
Yep.
We'll leave the rest up to the episode.
We got Donut Media on board this time, so it's going to be super fun, creative, and cool. Sam's going to be back. Andy, all the crew.
All the Donut crew. And Terry Crews. He's going to be on it.
Terry Crews.
Yep. Promised. He signed
Turk might show up, too.
Turk might even be there.
Whenever you need something broken, you know who to call.
All right, so let's move into, as I say, we got another fan box, which not to make our good friend Russell in Houston jealous because we haven't eaten his spaghetti yet, which we will get to. Let's keep on having all these guest episodes.
I thought Corey bought
that
for a snack.
He sent us an... He sent us, Russell sent us an entire box of different canned spaghettis.
Probably like 20-something
And also,
varieties.
Since we reached our first goal on Patreon, we said that we were going to eat spaghetti out of plastic bags for an entire show. So I think next episode we're going to be combining both Russell's spaghetti reviews and plastic Ziploc bags of spaghetti. And that's going to be the whole we didn't want to subject you to that, Chris, but next time, if you really want to be a part of that,
I do have to drive home, and I don't want to
have
to stop every hour.
You don't want a bag case of spaghetti belly.
Just take the bag with you.
But we got another care package of
a twofer.
This is from Mommin.
I think that's how you pronounce his name.
Mommin. He's gotta be super pissed because I think it's like the third time I try to say his name.
He has about $600 worth of stamps on
Ramen.
That thing.
Yeah. Mommin.
Bought the post office.
Yeah, let's see here.
What are you doing? Watch the 2013 glass.
Look at this. Handle with care, and it's fucking blown out all over the place. Yep.
Rewrapped. Yep.
This came all the way from New Zealand.
Where is this from?
Close. From Australia.
Yep. Same thing.
It's all the same.
And he sent us, and we're going to be reviewing these things and eating them on an episode. Yeah. They've got a snack that's called Shapes.
It's actually just hexagons.
We have to channel our inner mic.
The original name was just hexagons.
Damn shops.
So he sent us a gigantic box of Australian goodies, and this box must have cost a fortune. So thank you so much for sending us this stuff.
There's so many stamps. Yeah. Like poster stamps on it.
It's almost $2 a stamp.
I didn't realize
too.
This is Muhammad, which I think is we said his name, right?
Yes.
He's our bud.
So this is a guy who ripped us a second.
Oh yeah, that guy was awesome.
Yep.
Wait, what did he do?
He was my fan.
on our fan special episode.
He shit on us
we talked to him.
Yeah, I love it.
And he fired back.
Big fan
like
of that guy.
He ripped us.
Yep.
With gummies.
Let's see this.
And
party mix.
Oh wait, this Kinder Surprise. These things are illegal in the States, by the way.
Because kids, apparently you're not allowed to put plastic in your food. But
Paco, you just fucking broke it.
It's still alive.
Anyways, thanks a lot, Moomin. We're going to be eating this stuff at a future episode, and we're going to talk all about it. We appreciate you putting in the time and effort, buddy, and for listening to the show.
Make sure to continue to call back and put these guys in their
place. Get that shit out of here. We only drink NOS. What is that?
Warna V something. Not for individual sale.
Yeah, right.
Anyways.
You're not going to win any of the events with that stuff.
Of candy.
Thanks, Mom and Salamander.
Yeah, you're the man, bro.
You're the Mua man.
Man.
Now that we got that painful bit out of the way.
That was a great show, guys. Thanks.
All right.
Thanks, Chris, for bringing me on to open up your gifts.
So, Chris, what fucking gives you the right? Let's start there.
Yep.
Well, you invited me.
Whoa.
All right. Well, next question.
Okay, moving on. We're going to knock these right out.
All right. Next question. Who do you think you are, Chris?
That's good. Well, my name is Christopher Peter Forsberg.
Peter?
The third?
Christopher Peter.
Four Peter?
I don't
that's
know.
Like so that's who I think I am.
Oh, fair. Okay. Yeah. Well, any other questions for Chris?
I think we're done here.
Paco, do you have any? I know Paco does.
Have you ever competed in Formula Drift?
That was a bad question.
That was terrible. Yeah, well, yeah. I was wondering what it was like being born in Guadalajara there, Chris.
Well, it's...
Are you really Mexican, Chris?
It's been great, you know, like I first started out with a little Datsun. I wanted to kind of get it going. I was like, you know what? Like, actually, I should move to the States and start a body kit company. Right. And, you know, really want to take my creative control to, you know, an actual physical form.
Yep.
And then maybe one day I'll be able to start a podcast with my friends and, you know, I'll utilize my broken English to communicate to my fans.
I was going
to
say, give me your best Paco impersonation.
Oh, my God. He is ripped.
What? No, that's not my life story. That's my life story. My best Paco impression?
Yeah. Hey, my name's Paco.
Sound like Vaughn.
I talk like Vaughn all the time.
Really good. That was Paco doing Vaughn.
That was Paco Griffin Jr.
So what's an impression of an impression? What is that?
An impressionception?
Yeah. Impressionception?
Impression something.
So you have... Ryan Tjerk on your team, which you have been good buddies with Ry Guy for a while, and this is the first year that like previous years where you adopted Corey once.
Right.
Yeah. You've adopted a couple other really lost boys over the years. Mm-hmm. Is this an adoption of Ryan Turkleton, or is it kind of like a bros being partners?
No, this is definitely a full team effort. I've been friends with Ryan.
Because the other ones weren't, so.
The other ones were not, no. That's why he's sitting on the end.
Right.
man.
What?
Let's just so dead in for a second.
Hold on.
This is
a pro down, bro down.
All right, yeah. Well, no, let's back this up because obviously this is a long time.
We're hitting Corey right
this
in the
field. This is a long time coming, guys. You guys broke up years ago and you haven't been able to talk about it.
Yeah, so
Corey,
we could talk about it.
Corey, how do you feel?
I feel great.
It feels good.
I feel pretty good right now. At first, I it was like when you have that first girlfriend in high school and they leave you for no reason. And then you're like, well, God damn it, why did this happen? And then you just kind of get over it.
Yeah, so you're pretty much over it now?
I'm yeah. Well,
he looks over it.
Well, I look at the trend. And it's like, you know, you see that girlfriend that gets uglier and uglier boyfriends? That's what I felt like.
So now Turk is the culmination.
Turk is like, the ugliest.
And that's what makes me feel good. It's like, God, I've gone up, guys. I have gone up. I have been bettering myself from here on out.
Sorry about Corey yelling into the mic, by the way.
Sorry. It's all good. But, years past ago, when we first did our two-car team with Corey, we took his car, we helped rebuild it and kind of bring it up to, like, a pro level. We did a new engine package in it and redid all the suspension.
All the wood screws.
We took all the wood screws out of the fuel cell so he wouldn't burn alive in there.
Yep.
And, we made it a pretty tight and right car.
Right.
And you realized how horrible of a choice that was.
Like, I'll be honest, it was awesome. I think it was a really good time.
It was fun. Corey definitely had his shining moments and threw down some gnarly runs in that car. But it's FD's it's a real killer.
That was my second year in FD. Yeah. That was my second year in FD, and like for us at that time, I was like, what better opportunity than to learn from someone that's been in it for a long time? Because in 2012, the only person I had to look up to was Bubba Drift, which was a fucking nightmare to begin with. He was my spotter in Long Beach, and this is the guy that would say. Our 350Z didn't run Long Beach, but he's like, man, I would have put that thing on the podium first lap out. I'm like, this guy's a fucking maniac.
How's that possible?
I don't. And it didn't even run. And so that was kind of our starting of 2012.
And then you also had Dustin Jensen Argyle as your crew chief.
And he has tons of experience, like plethora. Yeah. He actually got Dustin actually in 2013 got second runner up of crew chief of the year.
Yeah,
he did.
Dustin was?
Really?
He
yes.
was in there.
Yeah, Dustin was nominated for crew chief of the year.
That was awesome.
That's incredible.
I would say maybe Formula Drift standards weren't.
Well, no, think about it. No, who won that year? Was it you guys or was it Osbo's team that won a crew chief of the year?
2012, I think that was.
No, 13.
13? Yeah. 2013, I think was no. Who was that?
Really?
Who won crew chief?
I think it was either Osbo. Or
I think it was.
So if you really
it wasn't us.
Look at the ranks. My crew chief was Osbo, Dustin, then MA. So I had one of the best out there in the business,
wow.
and I had a lot to look up to. But
You had Chris as your as your track coach. You had you had MA building your car, and you had Dustin as your nutritionist.
So we all saw your insane run from Irwindale and your recent post on Wednesday. Wall tap Wednesday, more like wall crushing every single corner
I have no control over that thing. I just sit in and hang on.
See, all you had to do was just reel it back just a touch. You know, you see you got those photos that you post up Atlanta.
I only have four good photos.
Blown a rear bumper off in Atlanta, blown a bumper off in Wall, blown a bumper off in Texas. Like, you just had to move back a touch.
Well, my favorite thing that I do now, and I don't know if you've seen it, but I post really bad pictures of me driving the car saying this is my 100-point qualifying run.
And those are
It is my favorite thing to post now. Like me burying it in the fence nose first. Like, guys, this was a rough run. We ended up sticking it 100-point again.
My favorite is your door-to-door with Danny George.
Oh, yeah. 16 car lengths.
And they're both straight.
I'm straight in the back. Do you know what? Honestly, that was probably one of only my 2 years, but it was definitely awesome. And I've been back before to FD a couple of rounds, but it was, I think how even driving to Texas with this moron over in the corner was awesome.
I was on your crew.
Paco was on my crew that year.
Yeah.
The funny thing about Paco on my crew is we had headsets. Paco never fucking took off the headset. He always was Mr. Important Paco walking around like, no, man, I do something.
And look at me.
He had a clipboard.
I was afraid that somebody was, hey, you get out.
So but I have a headset.
Well, but I have headset. Exactly. I have to look official. You know, like.
But outside of me not performing the best of my ability, I think that was probably the most fun of any form of motorsports I've ever had that year. It was absolutely so much fucking fun. And that's the only reason why I'd go back is obviously have fun and try to perform well.
You're going back to Formula Drift?
Yeah. This year we're doing it.
Is that
sure.
true?
It's true. Yep.
Is it true?
I signed everything. Got my driver's agreement in. Everything's done.
Does your
good to
car
go.
Have a transmission yet?
I have not got it yet. I have not received it yet.
I heard there might be one outside.
There might be one outside. I'm not sure.
Wait, what do you mean?
There might be a transmission outside.
Elaborate.
What, just like a lost one roaming the streets?
Right, so Chris has been a huge help of mine. He's been my mentor since I was
I would
six.
Say that you're his biggest fan.
Yeah. Yeah.
No,
so
he's your biggest.
I'm his biggest
right.
fan.
Yeah. So when I was 6 years old, I met Chris, and he told me he's had this transmission sitting in his garage and saving it for a special occasion. Mm-hmm. He ran it last year in his pro car and won the championship. So what he did, he goes, this is the one.
This
and he sorted me on my shoulders and knighted me. And then I had to pay him a lot of money for it.
And then, look, I'm going to give this to you for free.
$1 million.
For free. Plus I need you to give me a lot of money for it.
Yes. He sold
me. He's like, wait, you got a transmission for sale? I was like, yeah, I got money. He's like, how much you want for it? I was like, this much. He's like, well, how about this much?
Yep.
And I was like, you know what? Yeah, it's all good, Corey. That's cool. He's like, well, how about this much?
Well, yeah. And the other option was, he goes, dude, I got these box of Tim Tams, and if you buy these Tim Tams, I'll throw in the transmission for free. But it's almost like $12,000 for this thing.
Yeah.
So
Tim Tams are expensive. Yeah, and they came all the way from New Zealand.
Corey, you're a master negotiator.
I am. Yeah, I have been for a long time.
So you wrote the
come on, dude. I was fucking part of Chris Forsberg's team. Now everybody can talk themselves into that.
Yeah.
He even learned how to speak Costa Rican, and now
he's
sure fucking
So let me get these things. Let me get things
straight.
Gatos
Locos, right?
What, Paco?
Gatos Blancos.
Los Gatos Blancos. Yeah. That's what it is. See, so he remembers our crew, and I don't even.
I photoshopped your album cover.
You did that. Okay, cool.
The hottest,
no wonder he remembers.
That was the hottest
album
of
out of New Mexico.
What he's by the way, what he's referring to is me, Chris, Corey, and Dustin driving from Phoenix to Texas. We stopped at a truck stop and we all got do-rags. but here's the best part. They actually ran out of do-rags. They only had three, so I got a skull cap. And then we all posed outside the rig and took a photo, and then we were then a crew forever named Los Gatos Blancos.
Dude, that trip was so fun, actually, because we slept in the Walmart parking lot and
pounded bee smoothies,
mm-hmm. And that's when Dustin was light as farts on fire.
I do have video of that somewhere. Just Dustin getting real flamey. You know, I think if someone would have walked into that RV after like being in the fresh air and then walk into this place of just the odors of four men and farts and methane and fire and
sounds like Circus LA or something.
Perfect situation.
No, but it was, you know, looking back at that, it was super fucking awesome. And
those are the best years of your
life. Those are the best years, but
they're behind you now.
Yeah, they're way behind me now. And you know what I do is I create hype every year saying I want to be back, and I'm just waiting. I'm not going back yet. So we'll see.
This,
I might.
This season, how many pro-am rounds are there?
There's four.
So you're going to do like one
the
of them?
Pro-am.
Well, here's the thing. Okay, so I've talked about this last time. I don't know if I want to do Florida yet.
Why?
Because it's expensive.
And it's awful. But other than that.
So what I would do is, because there's LS Fest like the weekend before or after, and it's like, why would I go out there and come back to Holly LS Fest? Vegas, which is the first year, and I'm working with Holly this year. So I'm like, I might blow Florida off. I love Atlanta.
We're just going to blow a round of FD
yeah,
off.
Yeah, blow a round of FD say, like, off, charge it to the game.
I mean, Chris, you're a three-time
Thanks
champion.
Thanks, Formula Drift, for giving me a license.
Chris, you, you're a three-time champion. You blow off a lot of rounds, right?
I mean, that's the easiest way to win.
I mean, so when you just kind of don't feel like going to one, you just don't?
Yeah, it's far.
Yeah.
You know, so that's usually my excuse.
It's expensive.
I'm like, ugh, California. I don't know, guys. Yeah. Maybe we'll sit this one out.
I mean,
let's wait for Atlanta.
I mean, you do have a hot tub at your house. You're like, ugh, Long Beach is like at least a 30-minute drive for me.
Well, yeah, I mean, I don't know. Well, now, so I'm going to be at Long Beach now because I'm back in California.
Right.
So,
right.
Yeah, I mean, don't be ridiculous.
Yeah. But
yeah, we'll have to think about Canada.
Well, think about the calls you have to make to the team. It's like, guys, I've been fucking sit in my bathtub and hot tub all weekend, and
yeah,
I'm just gonna stay here. So let's unload the rig. Let's take a five.
You know,
it's a lot.
I know you guys worked real hard on the car getting it going, but I just really don't feel like going.
It's a lot of work to do pretty much everything. Like, I mean, that's why I waited 2 years until Forsberg was finally like, I'll fix your car, because it's a lot of work, and I didn't feel like doing
car,
it,
dude.
And that's kind of like Corey. Like, you're like, I suck at FD. I don't want to get better, and then like, I'll wait till Forsberg picks me up.
I'm waiting. Well, hopefully, when
my car won't run. I really need a transmission for the past 2 years.
Yep. I was talking about the first time.
It's in my house.
I was talking about the first time, but the second time, yes, you're saving him with the transmission. Are you gonna install it for him, or?
I fucking sure hope so.
I mean, I don't know how it's gonna get in there otherwise.
That was part of the deal,
yeah,
right?
Wait a second.
I mean, I saw him on his Instagram moving his wheel around. That was pretty impressive.
you can do that?
Whoa, look at guys. Look, I'm trying to turn it left and right. Look at this.
Dang, dude. Yeah,
so I spent a good hour up there working on that. Filming it.
Prepping for that shot.
Yeah, prepping for that shot. But
yeah, I mean, in all seriousness, like you said, you know, you've been taking your time, building your car, coming back into the scene because you know that it's a big endeavor to run Formula Drift, and you want to come back and be 100% ready. And, you know, that's kind of, you know, looking back at like 2013, that's, you kind of got thrown into that like a little bit faster than you should.
Which was awesome.
Yeah. Based on like how we talk about, you know, in years past, it was some guys would get like a quick fast pass right into FD and you would struggle. You know, going like from Pro-Am straight to FD. But now, you know, like Pro-Am's a little more developed, and now we have Pro 2 and is building those stepping stones.
Sorry,
and so now we're, Sam, sorry. Stop watching. I'm having a moment here, and you're watching videos.
No, it's a video for the
watching videos on his phone.
That's a maximum Driftcast check. Cause, like, what is Corey sending me here? And he's saying that we should all learn choreography and replicate it for the show of these guys dancing. So
I sent that like 3 hours ago.
So even better. So
that was Paco. My bad. Well, I don't honestly check my messages that often. So sorry. I do it whenever Chris is saying something heartfelt.
Yeah. He apparently
lost it by now.
But like we're saying, going back to like how in years past, it was tough to bridge that gap, you know, to go from Pro-Am. And like you said, you ran only 1 year of Pro-Am. Your first competition was
that year.
In 2011, right?
Yep.
And so like.
And you were the judge of that. It was XCC Phoenix. That was my first ever drift
competition
event. Yeah.
Yeah. Jeez. Yep. God. Yeah. That's right. I was a judge at that event. Yep.
And that's when Todd from Fuel Racing flipped all you guys off.
Yep. Yeah. Because
we should have done better, fucking guys.
Yeah. Because we didn't vote for you because you had a car actually straightened out or something. Like, he did a big burnout, man. I don't know why he didn't win.
I remember Jared and everybody just getting so happy talking about it.
All right. Thanks for coming.
Yeah. I'm sitting there like, God, this is my first event, and this is like fucking NASCAR all over again. People arguing and fighting.
Wait, some dude on your team or one of your sponsors flipped off Forsberg for not judging you correctly?
Yeah, like I made an obvious big mistake.
Yeah,
it was his first competition. Like, can you even blame him?
Yeah, and so I didn't even know how to use the e-brake.
That's right. You're running PIR with no e-brake.
Neither you or your team like knew even the rules.
No,
drifting. Right,
I didn't,
it was just like.
Yeah, it was. And so, anyways, I didn't do very good. I qualified like six, and
did do good. But like, you know, in tandem, you may have been.
I never
a mistake.
Tandemed before.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. Like, you did great. You qualified like in your lead position, and you made like a little mistake following someone because you kept your, you know, you
it was
control of the car, but like, you know, making the correction to keep your drift.
Right.
It was like something with that, and so we're like, you know, like he straightened out or you know, wiggled or whatever, and so. Give it to the other guy. Yeah, we got the old cold middle.
You guys
right
got
there.
Beat up by that guy. Just flipped off and yelled at. And then the other time was
sorry.
XCC Seattle. Yeah. That was my second event, and you guys were judges of that.
Yeah.
And
that's where you were killing it that
I
one.
I beat Chelsea.
You were Chelsea, yeah.
Yep, I beat Chelsea. And
wait,
I remember
Chelsea DeNova?
Yeah, and he complained.
Ooh, I heard he won FD once.
Yep, he may have, and
there
I
you
smoked
go.
That
yeah,
turd.
He's good.
Yeah, fucking, that's why that's
straight
so
up and
when,
down.
When Chelsea ever talks shit to me, I'm like, dude, I'm undefeated
yeah, remember
against
that,
you.
Remember that time? 1-0.
Yeah, I'm undefeated against you, dude, so bring it back. I don't give a sheesh.
But yeah, so we'll close this thought off real quick with, like I said, there was with XDC, that's kind of what we're trying to do is to build like a Pro 2 series, help to bridge that gap. But that kind of series came and left. But you know, now like you're saying, you want to take your time, get your car built, have
right.
a proper car, and be comfortable yep. with it before you show up and start competing again. Because yeah, like when you got thrown right into FD from Vegas, Vegas
right.
Drift,
yep.
like yeah, that's tough, you know. And you yep. you got through 2012, and you know it was rocky. You teamed up with us. We tried to. You know, give you like a more prepped car, but
yep.
it's still it's you're learning too much too fast, and you know,
well,
FD's doing a good job at having a series like Pro 2.
The
which
thing
going
about that
to.
Too is I would compare this. So my jump from Pro Am to my first year FD was a big jump.
Yeah,
but I would
we
also
we ran each other that year too.
We did run each other. Yep, that's my highlight reel. And then going from 2012 to 2013, the changes you guys made to the car and everything, just the team logistics, was as a big of an equal jump.
Yeah.
So it was like big jump and then a bigger fucking jump because now I'm driving an animal.
Wait, FD had jumps this year?
Yeah, hurdles.
We're doing jumps.
Yep. Yeah. But it was constantly big changes.
That's why all the FD cars
and
are so high.
Chris, okay. The other thing too, though, that I think about after looking at your guys' program is like, man, I would have operated so much differently on like a promotional marketing and logistics side that I could have done better, which like going back this year, it's like, I want Larry to do all my photos.
Yeah.
I want to get a video guy. I want to get... just things more streamlined because we'd go there and I'd shoot from the hip with Dustin and everybody. And it's like, if it was more streamlined, you get way more out of the sport.
Nah,
and,
having and content is overrated.
And I say, you know, the thing is like, always say winning.
Don't tell everybody.
Winning yeah. matters, but at the end of the day, as long as you can produce the content and get your sponsors what they want, mm-hmm. that's when we talked about this before. It's you can guarantee that. You can guarantee you're going to be there. You can guarantee you can get photos and media and content. Mm-hmm. You're not guaranteed to win. So as long as you can promise that.
Yeah. Well, no, there's a couple ways you can guarantee yourself to win. Have you ever heard of edible arrangements?
Yeah. See, Corey touché. Still hasn't figured it out.
Yeah.
You guys talk about it every week, but he still hasn't picked it up.
Well, good thing I got a box of goodies from New Zealand I can ship to their doorstep. So
Australia. They don't want that.
It's all right. Ryan Lantane needs to pick up some. He's like a buck 20.
International treats, I mean, that's the key to their heart.
Do you remember this is a direct quote from Lantane when he was here a couple weeks ago. He said, if it's not on a stick, if it's not in a vase, I don't eat it.
Kind of
true.
Put a stick on a candy bar.
Hey, I mean, Paco, can you hit me with a mimosa,
yeah.
please?
Yeah.
Top him up.
Why did you, when I said
Chris,
why did you look, like?
Top off 2013.
Chris, when I said that, you looked at me like, what are you talking about? But you know better than anyone, Mr. Three-time winner. Like, you give him flower pots full of candy bars. It's full of fruit. It's
That.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, the whole
right.
arrangement
yeah.
you have.
Stop.
The edible one.
Stop talking about Sam.
Sorry.
We did see a picture floating around of Lantane swimming in a NOS Energy drink spa.
Yeah, I mean, that's a given. You know, like, how else do you think he gets, you know, chilled out on the weekends?
That was one of the things that we talked about in the long car ride over here. It was like, all right, so now that NOS is a title sponsor of the series, Black Magic is as well, and Forsberg is now going to have Black Magic. First time Forsberg's going to win, the people are going to be like, stop yelling into the mic. People are gonna be like, oh, this guy comes out of nowhere and just wins, and he's got the title sponsors on his car. Like, oh, man, I can't believe how rigged this is. This guy's never won before.
One thing I think about is what type of would you get rashes if you go swimming in a bath of gum out?
No, yeah, you get stronger.
That's true. It's like Spider-Man.
Paco,
you haven't talked for a while. What's up?
What would happen if you go jump in a tub full of black magic?
You come out as a witch doctor.
Yeah, you come squeaky clean.
Yep.
Yeah, you heard it here first. Chris Forsberg advocating.
You gotta spray yourself with black magic. You'll be fine.
I heard that if you spray it in your eyes, it washes them right out.
Also, tears.
You can no more. Yeah, are you tired of crying, little baby? Pour some black magic in your eyes.
I guarantee you have no more tears.
No more tears, guaranteed.
I don't know if Sam got the Goldilocks shampoo reference.
What?
No more tears.
I didn't use that. I used
good
it.
Point, Paco.
My mom used the shampoo that made me cry harder.
I was saying like,
he doesn't
probably,
use shampoo.
Probably,
Paco uses just for men.
Yeah, hey. I was saying I should probably need to use something else to combat that gray hair of yours, man.
Why would I want to combat it?
When I was born,
embrace it.
Or what cost it, actually?
A silver fox.
Yep. Yeah.
You fucking trying to understand your sentences,
yo,
Paco.
Watch the F-bombs.
Well, Paco. Yeah,
what?
Paco.
I said you.
This is a child's podcast. Yeah.
Wait, what did I say?
You said fuck you, Paco.
You said fucking fuck.
Yeah. Oh, well.
That's too many F's in one sentence.
So what we were talking about is what shampoo we use. Paco, did your mom use Nair?
My mom?
Yeah.
Mommy. It's called Mommy.
Your mommy.
Mommy.
No.
She didn't?
I thought I did once.
Oh, did you?
Yeah.
Nice. Yeah. All right, well, that's all I have for Paco. Cool.
Thank you.
Chris, what do you want to talk about? I know you usually don't have access to fans or microphones.
Yeah. Yeah.
What do you want to talk about, Chris?
Yeah, is there anything cool?
You never do any media-related stuff.
No. So. I try and keep to myself and just want to work on my cars. And be
just want to work on my cars.
Like an old man.
I mean, that's half
get
true.
But
it's half true about you, though. I mean, Chris could probably just sit in his garage playing with cars for the rest of the year and be okay.
Yeah,
I mean, Formula Drift is just so you can play with your cars in your garage. Now, so you moved to California. You built a Datsun.
I did.
You are about to build my car.
Yep.
God.
So
let's talk about my car.
No. I'm just saying, life for you, in California is good. You're not doing the harsh winters in Maryland.
Yeah.
We learned from John Hoyung a couple of weeks ago that he's building your car.
Yep.
You're not really involved in that. You're involved in the build, of course, but you're not getting your hands dirty on the car, which is kind of new for you because I think in previous years you've been getting your hands dirty on the MA cars.
Yeah. So, yeah, circling back to that, teaming up with Turk. Full team effort, mind you, Corey.
That's awesome, dude.
That's how we got started here.
So I do enjoy working on cars. Like you said, I always like to get my hands dirty in the shop and doing builds and or being a part of the program. But this is actually first year for me to be completely hands off of the Pro Car program. Obviously, being involved with the build conceptually with John Hoyango over at Nameless Performance and the rest of the team. But they're handling it top to bottom, which is great. It allows me to focus on doing more fun things like building content, doing stuff like Drift Garage, doing other shoots with you guys and the Donut Bros. And, that's one of the other main reasons why I moved back to California. I mean, I love it out there. I lived there from 2003 to 2012 before I moved out back east to team up with the MA guys and get back to Club Loose and start doing those events,
Yeah.
But, it's good to be back in California. The social media kind of scene has exploded since the time that I left. And so now being back and full time and available to do these shoots and everything else.
And you're also doing non-drift related, it's performance drive. What do we call it? And it's not stunt driving. It's precision.
Like precision.
You've been doing some precision driving.
Yeah,
I've been
doing some stunt driving gigs, and being in California opens those doors as well because sometimes you get that call and it's like, are you available in 2 days? And so being available for things like that. I mean, that's all the main reasons why I wanted to get back to California. And my wife Michelle is from California, so I know she loves it out there. And her family's right around the corner. So it's definitely a great situation all around for us. And, the Nameless guys handling the Pro Car entirely is great because, like I said, I would like to get in there and get my hands dirty and work on the cars and load the rig and everything else. But
you're not going to be driving the rig either, right?
Yeah, I'm being a little sarcastic there. I do not like load the rig at all. But
you did do it.
But
at times,
the job's got to get done, and it's all hands on deck. And if you want to win, you got to work hard. And no matter what. But it's a small changing of scenarios right now where
you're gonna show up like a week before Long Beach and be like, hey, is my car ready? You better fucking be John.
I'm just gonna have to make sure that instead of loading the edible arrangements in the rig myself, I'm just gonna have to ship them to the judges directly. We want to make sure that that's handled, so I'll still be handling that portion of the team effort.
Cool.
Is it stressful at all though, just like not being there, like touching your car?
I do get a little anxious about it, and not that I don't trust them at all.
Right.
It's more so because I, just like being involved and like to see, the car come to life and, have a little bit of input on what's going on. But, even if I was working on the car involved, I wouldn't be, accountable for anything drivetrain related. That's where we would kind of, set ourselves apart. I'd let the team and the crew.
Yeah.
Handle anything, engine, drivetrain,
You'd be welding
even,
on
even
the truck
mostly
nuts.
Suspension related. And yeah, like I'd help out with, you know, like body stuff, you know, like any, like, you know, small things like seats, harnesses, stickers,
right.
You know,
but at least you got to see like the progression of your car,
yeah,
as
no,
it's happening day to day.
Yeah. Yeah. And so that, but you know, like I said, once, like if you're, you know, even as a team owner and, you know, wanting to be a part of the team on a, you know, mechanic level, you still want to have that separation so that
right.
when you get to the track, everyone knows their role and their job and they can handle the car and the drivetrain. And, you know, like I said, once again, like more so like accountability. So,
and they can't blame you if it's broken.
Yeah. It's like, yeah, Forsberg, you didn't put any oil in the freaking engine.
You have always been... I mean, your team owner or your team, you never really like drove for anybody.
No, I did drive for other teams in the past, but
oh, okay.
It was always a car that I had either helped build.
You were still involved.
Yeah,
you,
yeah,
you
exactly.
weren't just like showing up to drive and.
Yeah, so
okay.
I've been running my own team, so to speak, Chris Forsberg Racing, for lack of better words, since 2007.
Oh.
And. Before that, 2004, the first year of FD, I was driving my own personal car, the SR Power 350Z with Motorex, and that was a car that I built. I started the build in Pennsylvania, moved to California at the end of 2003, and then got teamed up with the guys over at Signal Auto and Tanabe USA, and they helped me kind of develop the car into more of a drift car, you know, helped me, you know, see things like, you know, lightening it up, getting more angle out of the car. It was a brand new chassis. It was a 350Z in 2003. So it was,
and that's
brand
like the
and,
series is also still very.
Oh yeah, so no,
starting,
yeah,
like,
yeah, I mean, getting to that, yeah. So the Signal and Tanabe guys who were big in the drift scene back in 2003, the Signal Auto twins and everything. So I was like,
yep.
driving with those guys, and that was fun through that off season. But they were not able to run a full season of Formula Drift when they announced it at SEMA 2003 404, and so they.
What
decided
was the full season back then?
Four events.
Okay.
Yeah, four events. And so that's when I got linked up with the guys at Motorex. They were like, we want to do FD. They were, you know, kind of in tie with a couple companies in the industry, and they wanted to move over in that direction of drifting. And so got teamed up with them. And so they basically sponsored my already built car that already had the SR and everything else in it, and helped handle all the logistics of, you know, transport, flights, hotels, and everything else to get me to all the rounds. We podiumed the first... two Formula Drift events in Atlanta and Texas.
Boom.
And yeah, we had a great year. And then from there, Falcon was in the scene in 2004, of course, but then 2005 is when they kind of like hit it big. And that's when myself and the rest of the DA crew, Vaughn, who was already on Falcon from 2004, but he moved into the Mustang. I moved into the S15. Tony Angelo built a FD Arc 7.
Yeah.
And Hampton was in a... right-hand drive S13, Kaguchi's old car, actually.
Such a crazy thing to think about that you guys were all Team Falcon 1 year.
Yeah, yeah, and so we were the original blue and greens.
Yeah,
and which is funny to think, you know, way back in the day, 2004 or 5, and so we did that in 2005, and then 2006 I went back to Z chassis. Nissan was getting a little more on board, and they wanted to see another 350 back out in the field, and so I got my convertible 350Z. We built that up, and that was a Sears wrapped Falcon car.
That SR powered.
Yeah.
Which is crazy to me to think it's an SR powered 350Z. That's like, you know,
that was 04. That was 04.
Oh, was it?
The 06 car, that was the VK.
Okay, that
so
was
that
the first
was
VK.
Yeah, so that was the first car in FD to have a V8 that didn't come with one.
Hot damn.
Yeah.
That's cool, man.
Think about that for a second.
Oh, I'm thinking about it.
That was the first time that a car came, that somebody brought a car with a different engine that came?
Not different engine, but a V8.
V8.
Yeah. To more specifically a V8. So the first V8 swapped car that wasn't, Reese's GTO. Obviously, Sam had the Vipers at the time.
Yep. Yeah.
And I think the old Camino was running around at that time as well.
Christ.
So he had the V8. But yeah.
Chris, can I just correct you for a second here?
Sure thing.
Vipers have V10s.
That's what I said.
You said, I thought you were talking about V8s.
No. Well, I said, and you know, Sam had the V10 with the Viper. I slid that in there.
God damn it.
Yep.
I thought I could
open
correct
your
you.
No way, dude.
I thought I could correct you for a second.
Open your ears, Sam.
In my mind.
Yep.
But built that car in 06, and then that was a rocky year for me. It was a brand new build, a brand new drivetrain, and we had a bunch of issues with it. And it was one of my worst years of an FD. And so
where'd you finish?
12th.
That's better than my worst year.
That was rock bottom, 12th place.
Rock bottom. And
that'd be tough.
So,
So it yeah, it was a rough year, and Falcon and I parted ways, and moving into 2007, I Kevin Wells, who is now the technical inspector of Formula Drift, but he was my crew chief from 2005 and 2006. So he was like, "Yep, I'm down. Let's do it. Let's party." So we kind of tuned up the same chassis, kept the same engine and chassis package, the VK powered 350Z. Brought it back out in 2007, orange with Maxxis, and went on to get second place behind Tanner in the championship.
You know, it's crazy, though. The one thing we talked about yesterday is that when you first ran the VK, it was 300 and something horsepower, right?
318 wheel.
That's a shit ton.
Which is...
Hey, by the way, speaking of Kevin...
Yeah, I'm pretty sure FD car's idle at that now.
Hey, yeah. I found a picture of Kevin the other day, and I was going to text it to you, but that's a pretty awesome picture.
Yeah, bleached hair? Yep, yeah. There it is.
He looks like the lead singer Green Day.
So Kevin, what? No, he looks like a goddamn Slytherin.
I was going to say, I guarantee it's when he had bleached hair, right?
Yep. Yeah, it's the lead singer of Orgy.
Yeah, so where can the internet go see this?
That's 2007 right there.
So if you follow Kevin Wells at Instagram and go to 2007, are they going to see this?
No, you won't find a 2007 Instagram. It didn't exist back then, you stupid idiot.
Well, why don't we?
Yeah, come on, dude.
That was the joke, dude. Yeah, but can we? Do you think would he be mad if we posted that to Maximum Driftcast?
I don't know. I mean,
I don't think it would hurt.
We'll have to ask him. I can't speak for him.
Do you know what I'll do? Instead of photoshopping the trophy out, I'll put like a Bud Light can or a Dr. Pepper can
Coors,
in his hand.
Coors Light.
Coors Light, yeah, or a Dr. Pepper.
Yeah, or Dr. Pepper. Yeah, a big gulp. A double gulp. That's more like a quadruple gulp.
Yeah.
It's crazy how much you developed your VK, though, because, you know, it was making, with nitrous, of course, what, like almost 1,000 horsepower? Could?
Yeah, we were, I'd say at the crank, we're breaking 1,000 horsepower. At the wheels, it's hard to measure at the wheels because... Because
you have that restrictor in the drivetrain to take about 400 horsepower.
Yeah, we pull about 400 out of it.
So about 500.
Yeah. Maybe 400.
From what I heard, you were really comfortable in the Sears car, so you wanted that similar power.
Yeah, so we went back.
Yep, so you had a thing you created, you showed me, it was like a diaphragm.
And a diaphragm,
and
yeah.
It was like one of those, you know those pedal bikes you ride at the gym? Oh, look at
Sam's
mom just showed up.
We have a... Hold on.
She's telling us to be quiet.
We have a guest.
Special guest.
She's telling us to be quiet. Hold on.
Oh, you're trying
Drift,
to be quiet.
Drift Mom is here.
Very quiet.
Okay.
You can
she
say
just
hi.
Made a guest appearance.
Hey. She's wearing a Dotson shirt.
Come here.
It's a Forsberg.
Come here. Oh, my God.
Look at that.
Paco, you don't need to move the furthest mic to her.
Hey. Chris, do not try to slide in on Sam's mom.
I'll do my best.
Tell me about your shirt, Mom.
By the way, this is Corey Hosford dressed as Sam's mom.
Yep.
We had that before.
She's off camera.
Talk close to the mic.
I won this.
How?
Lovely Mitch just came up and handed it to me.
Wow. Oh, that's
Chris's wife just handed it to me.
So you didn't win it. You got it for free.
Yeah, but I call it winning because I got to sit with your group while he was racing in Texas.
Awesome.
Oh. Right. So if you couldn't tell, my mom is a fanboy. Well, she's gonna heckle us from the corner of the room for the rest of the show.
Yep.
I'm the audience.
She's the audience. Oh God, this is a lot of pressure.
We have a whole audience.
Oh shit.
This is a lot of pressure.
Yep. Oh boy. Yeah.
It's like
keep it together.
It's like when I got a skateboard in sixth grade. I was like, Mom, watch my kickflip, and then I couldn't do it.
For those who don't know,
Was out there with the camera.
Yeah, just taking shots each time I fucked it up.
For those who don't know, Sam still lives at Mom's house. He lives in the
basement.
Say it, Paco. Yep.
Yeah, it's called basement.
Say it.
Yeah.
Say it.
Hey, instead of like throwing in words for Paco,
in the underhouse,
we should let him keep thinking until he comes up with the word.
Yeah, that's
yeah.
True.
We'll just let the podcast stall.
He goes
for a
that
minute.
One thing.
We'll edit on post. It's fine.
to keep talking about drifting. So
before we go there,
go back to not drifting.
Before we talk about drifting,
yeah, back to the
basement.
House.
The basement.
Yes, exactly.
Underhouse.
No,
yes.
Actually, do you know where all these cars are? Like all these previous cars you own?
Burned them.
You
went the old
house.
Some. Yeah, I know where some are. So my SR Power 350Z, I sold it to a team over in Belarus with Thank You John.
Okay. So yeah, he and his guys bought it. It's actually, I saw it when I went out to EEDC in 2014.
You recently went inside, right?
I saw it, yeah. And it still had the same paint and the same wheels and everything.
Nice. That's awesome.
The stickers had changed, of course, but it looked very similar to how I left it, which is crazy. And
so they still drive it?
Since then, yeah. But then it was kind of sitting for a while. But since I saw it, they ran it last year on a couple events. So it was cool seeing some photos online pop up with me tagged on them and seeing that car still rip around with the same SR that I left in it. See, Sam, they can run.
I believe you.
That thing ran forever. And nice. The convertible car I also sold. It was to Amandio, who came into the scene in 2012, right?
Yeah, I think
2011. Yeah, that's right. Halfway through 2011, he showed up in Vegas for the first event.
Yep.
And so yeah, sold it to him, and that car apparently, from what I last heard, is sitting somewhere in NorCal in a shop somewhere. I don't know,
That's cool.
Yeah, and the S15. The whole reason why I got into the convertible was because the S15 kind of disappeared, for lack of better words.
Wow.
It was,
what do you mean?
I drove it my one of my favorite events of all time, one of my favorite weekends of all time. Sam, you remember the story from last night? Was Irwindale 2005, yep. When I won my first Formula Drift event. And it was in the Nissan S15.
And so right-hand drive?
It was right-hand drive, yeah. And so, yeah, that was a whole nother thing to deal with. Yeah. But, yeah, so...
Well, to summarize your perfect weekend, though, we were at the bar as I was beating him at pool.
let's just bring that back up.
Yeah, just bring it back up.
This was after you beat me at darts.
Yep.
We'll mention that.
Yep. Chris had said this weekend you won Formula Drift, like all your family and friends were there to see you win your first Formula Drift event.
Yep.
And then your house is on the way back, so you partied at your house immediately after.
No, that was a different.
Then so then the next day,
why don't you let him tell the story then, Sam?
Well, no, I'm not letting. I'll tell you exactly why Chris isn't going to tell the story, because it would last 15 minutes. Okay, yeah, Chris, am I right?
We don't have enough time for
I
that.
I know. Okay, thank you. So then, Chris, you then went to a metal cover band, and they let you on stage to sing.
Well, it was actually
wait.
To challenge.
Was this the high kick contest?
Yeah.
Oh my God.
It was actually
yes.
to challenge the lead singer in a high kick competition.
That's right. Okay.
So,
wow. All right. Let's. We should spend time on this. Go ahead.
Yeah. And so I sent the band a few edible arrangements before the weekend.
Right.
And I got pulled up on stage as I was being pointed by all my friends that I could out kick the lead singer of Metal School.
And weren't sure if you could high kick.
Oh, I was very sure.
Okay.
High kick.
Oh, yeah.
And and so I got dragged up on stage and out high kicked Michael Starr, and ooh, then proceeded to sing Maiden on stage for a minute or so.
Yeah.
They're like, all right, you should probably get off the stage.
You're better at high kicking than singing.
Oh, so. He was probably too good at singing. And then they were like, you know what, stick to drifting, pal. We don't need this much competition in the metal cover band world.
Yeah. It was a pretty good weekend.
It's still the best weekend of your life. That's all been downhill from
2000. Yeah, straight downhill since.
Well, I want to see like a VH1 Behind the Music with that band. It's like 2011 was the peak, and then lost in like a high kick contest. They got addicted to drugs. Everybody quit the band, and
the attendance started going down.
Yeah.
So, okay, so that S15.
Oh, yeah. So, it was, long story short, I'll do this the best I can. Irwindale 2005 won the event, and the chassis was owned by a company called Password JDM, which is why that was the big logo on the side of the car.
I know that name, but what did they do? I don't remember.
They're just like an import shop based out of SoCal. And so he owned the chassis, and through partnerships and with Falcon, like we provided basically the rest of the car. It was essentially an S14 with a S15 chassis on it. So,
liar.
Because it's all the same stuff, man. Yeah, so like we got like all S14 components from other companies, and control arms, subframes, and everything else. And so we built the car, put it together, and after Irwindale, they took the car to do a photo shoot, as like the winning car and everything else. I never saw it again.
Really?
Yeah.
What? Falcon disappeared it, or
I don't really have all the facts of that story, but that was. That night when it caught on fire, we won the event, and everything else was the last time I ever saw that car.
Huh. Wow.
Yeah. If anyone can find the whereabouts of this car, I wish we had
I'm sure people know where it is.
I know where it's at. I know where it's at.
I know people know where it is. It's not a mystery. It's just the fact that they decided to keep it from that point, and so I had to scramble the convertible car together, which turned into, like I said, one of my worst FD years because I had to whip an FD car together in like 2 months.
Do you know where I saw
it? And it didn't even make Long Beach. I had to drive the SR car at Long Beach 2006.
I'm trying to think. Oh, do you know where I last saw that car, actually?
Where?
I saw it in New Jersey, like, last year. It fucking broke something and coming off the bank and somebody hit it. That was the last time I saw the car. I don't know. It was the last time I saw it. Sorry.
Yeah. Sure, anyway. Sure. I don't understand the
100% sure it was relevant to that story. S15, right?
Yeah, it's the last time I saw an S15 in the series, so I thought it was yours.
Could have been.
Yep.
So then, what? So 2009, you had a sweet car, and then this guy kept on hitting it.
2009?
Yeah, that happened. That's a fun story.
I don't even know. I don't want to get deep into the story, but when we were driving the 6-hour drive, I got to hear a 6-hour history of Form of the Drift, essentially.
I was trying to bridge your guys' gap from when you were born to 2012, because you guys don't know anything about drifting.
Absolutely not.
I'm still not 100% sure we know enough.
I think we know
today. We know enough. You know enough for your audience.
I would say we know just about everything there is to know. And anything that I don't know, I can just lie about.
Yeah. Right. Oh, 100%.
Just lie about it, and then I'll come pop out of your bedroom and
fix it. What were you doing in there, dude?
Can we say that Forsberg came out?
You told me to go into your bedroom and wait for you.
Yeah, when you hit the cue, come out.
That's not weird.
This is how it's all scripted.
To call me out is why. Yeah. The end of that sentence.
Yeah, okay. Yeah.
It all stopped.
You told me to go into your bedroom and wait.
I'll be there in a minute.
Hey, Chris, why don't you wait inside my closet?
And then Paco,
you come out of that
taking
closet.
You're taking
Paco,
it to a different
come on, man.
That was a really bad impression of me as well.
Yeah. Hey, Paco.
Do I sound like a big bully to you, don't I? Then,
hold on. What was 2009? A bunch of crashes? You got crashed into?
He got crashed into a couple times.
Yeah, it was a fun one.
Was that the Z again?
It was my Z. It was we can try and make this story brief and stick straight to the facts, and we'll let the rest
we
lie.
Love facts here, so let's hear it.
We love facts. So quick facts will set the precedence. It was 2009 Sonoma, second to last round Formula Drift, and I was at that point leading the championship by a small margin. But we had a successful first half of the year. Turk actually won Long Beach and got third place Atlanta. So
can you believe that, guys?
Yeah, he was leading the points off of the first half of the year and doing great, and just had a couple loose events in the middle. And Tyler McCrory was also just kind of like chipping away and in the top three as well. And so we get to the second to last round of FD, and it's the points are set. I'm sitting in first. Tyler and Turk are in second and third, and we're like the three horses in the chase for the championship. And so Turk gets knocked out.
Fact.
Right? Yeah.
I'm saying these are the facts. This is not fact. These are not disputable.
Alternative.
Turk gets knocked out, top 32.
Fact.
Tyler McCrory is getting ready for his top 32 battle. His car won't start.
Fact.
What car was he driving?
The ASD built V8 powered convertible 350Z.
Oh, okay.
So it was the first
year—the
first year of the super ASD cars.
Got it.
Like the NASCAR powered, like changing the game, 850 horsepower, sprint car motor, nice. NASCAR
it was
transmission.
The first Drift Crisis. The second being Dago's 1200 horsepower car. But this was like the first wave
that
of Crisis.
Yeah,
the second.
That's a good way to put it. Yeah,
and fun fact: Dago barely beat me Rookie of the Year in 2012.
That is a fun fact.
So I just wanted to squeak that out there.
Yeah.
So anyways, so JTP's car doesn't start. Turk.
No, Tyler McCrory.
Tyler
McCrory. Yeah, okay. Well, they're all the same.
Yeah, one drives a Camaro, the one drives a Mustang. The same.
It's all the same.
Which one's Conrad?
Used to drive a Camaro.
And right. Getting back to it. And I'm on the bottom right of the ladder, right? So I'm one of the last guys to go. And so now it's like, oh, man. Like, two and three are knocked out. Forsberg still has to go. If I, moved on to top 16 and or further, it would almost solidify a championship. Not to say like 100%, but we'd have a huge margin because those two guys are out, obviously. Right. So I'm lined up against Calvin Juan, who was driving a different Falcon S15. Not my S15, but a different
not
one.
Not the missing
S15. There was another one.
Yeah.
And that car is actually Taniguchi's old car.
Yeah.
Fun fact. So, and so we're lined up to run, and to make a long story short, I lead first. He was chasing. I pitch into the first corner, and he hit my front wheel hard enough to break the lower control arm off. Oof, okay. And so we get dragged back up to the pits. We call 5 minutes, and the clock is ticking down. At this point, there are no rules of fault and getting the push by. That's kind of where these rules came from.
Right. We've learned that a lot of rules over the years have been made because of times Chris has been directly fucked by them.
Well, I thought, back hey man, when you're around from the beginning, you are the butt of
the rules.
Rules that don't exist yet.
Yeah, back then I thought it was a 25-minute rule. Was that not implemented yet instead of a 5?
Yeah, not yet.
Just to keep the show rolling, they bumped it back to 25.
Yeah,
and so So it's, clock's ticking down, and Doug, who at the time was running start, he's like in my window like, 1 minute, 30 seconds, and we're like, dude, like, he hit us, like, this is not cool, and so we're like, screw it, and Kevin throws a ratchet strap around the wheel, and to try and help prevent the wheel from, pushing back into the firewall, and so we just pull up to the line, and they're like, you're going to run like this? And I'm,
didn't give me much of a choice, pal.
Yeah, I know. I'm like, well, you literally just told me if I don't pull to the line that I lose. So I will drive anything that still moves.
Which is crazy, though, like to set a precedent like that, is that you could just nail someone like as hard as you could. If you're the follow car, you could just T-bone them. And if their car is broken and yours is running, like, well, looks like I won.
Yeah.
Hey-o.
And that's how it was. This was the first time of like of a real direct impact like that, where one driver was not at fault clearly, and we had to deal with that because we didn't have that much close tandem at the time. And so we pull up to the line, they're just like all hemming and hawing at the car, looking at it back and forth on the radio, and they're like, you gonna run this thing? I'm like, yeah, like you told me if you I don't this, I forfeit.
See this ratchet strap? It's good. Yeah. Good to go.
And so they're like, all right. And so drop the lights, take off, and I do a chase run behind them with one wheel kind of flopping back and forth in and out, and so we go down, we pitch in, and hit the first corner. The inside wheel is just kind of flopping around, doing its own thing. And we get all the way through the first corner, like sticking with them, transfer back through, all the load transfers onto the front right wheel. That thing digs into the firewall, and it spins out. And they're like, oh, man, that sucks. 0-0, one more time. And so we're like, God. So we rip up back to the pit, and we're like, 5 minutes. Because at this time, there were no rules on –
How many 5 minutes?
So,
if you need a little break after each round, just
People used to call 5 minutes to cool their cars down all the time.
Sure.
And so that's like where a lot of these rules came from. Yeah, they'd be like, oh, my car's overheating. 5 minutes. And we'd be standing around while someone sprays their car up because they don't have a big enough radiator.
That must have been really fucking bad to watch.
Yeah, it was really annoying. And so we jack it up. We start getting ready to fix it. And they come running over. They're like, you can't work on your car, blah, 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 blah. And so there was this big miscommunication on us being allowed to or not being allowed to work on our car again. And there was, like I said, there was no rule against calling 5 minutes multiple times. And it had happened at other events, of course. And so we're like fine, whatever, blah, blah, blah. Like, drop the car, pull up to the line. I do two more runs, 85-mile-an-hour entries with the front wheel just driving into the firewall. And almost made it through both times, like, just wheel digging in and spinning out on the left-hander, but got all the way through the right-hander each time. And so they give the win to Calvin. And so this event was actually, we hopefully would have gotten the same point across in a current form of drift event because there's halftime, right? We have like 2 hours between top 32 and top 16. But at this event, more specifically, it was the same weekend as an IndyCar race. And so we actually did top 32 on Friday, and top 16 was on Saturday. And so we were like going back and forth with FD, like, you guys, didn't allow us a 5 minute call that we made. And, there's nothing in the rule that says we can't have more than 5 minutes, multiple 5 minutes. And we couldn't justify on the ethics of someone running into us, because that wasn't a black and white rule. And so we just had to err on, the black and white of the rule book, saying that we were denied a 5 minute call that we requested. And so they granted it to us, and they re-ran us on Saturday morning. So first thing. Saturday morning is me and Calvin rematch, right? And my spotter Scott, who was Turk's crew chief at the time, who was in the running of the championship for us, will still to this day say that we screwed them on them winning a championship because they gave us that rerun. That should have never happened. We're like,
I'm sure this Calvin guy loves you.
Yeah, that too. And so, yeah, and so it's Saturday morning, and everyone saw what happened and was like, oh, my God, right? And so it's the start of Saturday morning, the start of top 16, and, like, everyone in the hot pit is just, like, lined up behind the start line. It's, like, you got all the crew, all the teams and everyone because it's, like built up, and they, you know, talked about in the driver's meeting, like, how, like, what happened. I mean, everyone saw Calvin, you know, like, drive into my car and break the wheel off and everything else. And so, it, like, things are heated, right?
Right.
It's getting pretty heated now. And so we take off, you know, for our third run, but essentially the rematch. And I'm leading again. I go down, I pitch into the first corner, I get all the way down through, and right at the same point, before I hit interclip one, he hits me hard enough in the front end to, like, you know, like, bam, like, smash into me. And, like, before I could even, like, look up to be like what the, you know, like, over my shoulder, boom, hits me again, like, just like in the throttle, and had enough speed to hit me, like, just bounce off my car
twice. And I just realized the funniness of this is that you said a minute ago this wasn't like the tight tandem days either, like, it's not like you guys are riding door to door before this.
I mean, we can all look back at
totally blatantly,
at videos from those days, and there wasn't very much tight tandem.
We're not throwing opinions on this, pocket we're just saying these are facts that occurred.
These are facts.
he was hit twice,
and facts. On the second time I got hit twice, but missing the front wheel, so it bounced off my door twice, messed up his alignment, and my car was fine, just cosmetically damaged. By the time I pull back around and get up to the pits, there were, like, people pushing and shoving each other around, like, it was gnarly. People were like turning against a certain team and like yelling and screaming in their faces and like losing their minds. It was nuts.
Wow.
And so, like, We didn't even, you know, work on our car, call five or anything. I was just heated, right? And just pulled right back up to the line, just sitting there, just waiting to go. And they called five, and they're working on his car. And, like, everyone's, like, over in their pit, like, you know, I'm not say everyone, but there were people, like, over by their pit, like, yelling at them and stuff. And it was intense. And needless to say, he pulled back up to the line. We finished the run. We win. I actually got knocked out the second round in top 16 to Steph Verdier, who went on to
second
place.
Right after,
who but still, like, developed those points, you know, for the finale. But Steph Verdier went on to get second place in that event in the Subaru, who I lost to, and we went on from that event to Irwindale and won the championship. But it was a Sonoma was gnarly.
As I say, why I think that story is kind of important too is we thought that 2016 was a crazy year for Formula Drift and controversy and shit. Like, that is so much bigger. It is before my time. I didn't even know a story existed until yesterday. Which is, like, so mind blowing to hear that. There was this.
It's always.
It's funny because this is all before, like, you know, like, a lot of, like, videos
or before
and
the
everything
internet.
Else. And so,
yeah, I couldn't.
So Sam's
find,
like, trying to find video of the crash and everything else, and
there's, like, no video record that
it's
this happened.
To find it,
so we're just going off of what Chris is saying. So
and we all know that's true.
Well, he has a pretty good track record.
Well,
of telling the
truth. If Calvin Juan wants to call in on the show, we would love to hear what he has to say about it. Get all the facts. So then, all right, we got a call from him.
Wow. No, that's not a real call.
I was going to say, Paco, do you want to do your Calvin Juan impression?
Hey, it's me. It's me, Calvin Juan. Got to tell you how much I hate you.
It's good.
I totally would hit your car again if I could.
Yeah.
But yeah, that was those are wilder times. I try and tell you, Sam, that you missed out on some wild times.
Well,
but, you know, to say that our best days are behind us is
absolutely true.
Is true for some people, but it's, no, like, I love, you know, FD, which is why I'm still doing it. But, you know, like, when you're involved with something from the beginning, and, there just are situations that haven't happened yet.
Yeah.
Almost every event. And so, certain things happen and rules get kind of developed, through the years. And so, to say that, you know, rules were built off of, you know, your bad situation, but then again, it's for the betterment of the sport.
Yeah. Well, I'm not saying that in a negative way. I'm just saying that something occurred and they're like, well, we can't let this happen again.
Yeah.
Well, isn't there only three people really running in the series now that was with it at the beginning? It was you, Vaughn, and Kanguchi, right?
Yep.
And that's
Daijiro.
Daijiro, yep.
Yeah.
So there's four people in the series that's actually competed at almost every single drift
event. Yeah, Vaughn is the only person who technically missed Irwindale last year, but has been at every round since day one.
Well, he tried to drive his fun haver, but they weren't having
that fun. Yeah.
Wow. None of that's true.
Yeah, you think wow. You don't assume that FD would take advice from somebody who runs the series for a year and like, this is a crock of shit. All right, I'm out. Yep. Probably won't take those guys too seriously, but you know, out of you four, it's probably like, okay, these guys have been through some shit, so let's.
I just thought of something. Do you remember when you lend your 370Z to Mod Moik?
Oh man, Mike!
And you offered
from D1 in, did?
Yeah, sure, bro.
What you're talking about is in Formula Drift New Jersey this year when Jeff was out and.
Well, they didn't let Mod Moik
right,
run the
introducing
car
because the scenario.
He already was, had run his car on.
Yeah, it was. So it was Friday. On Thursday, Mike was having a bunch of issues with his car, his MX-5, and so come to Friday, they worked on it all night, and they line up, they go to practice, they pull out on track, and he kind of like just whipped it down the straight, did like a little, not even like a half run, just around the bank, and did like a little kick around the one corner, pulled off track, and they're like, nope, this thing's definitely done.
Right.
Pull back into the pits, and one of the members of the team, Mickey Andre, who actually, looking back at the Falcon days, mm-hmm. Mickey was one of the original Falcon guys back in 2004 and 2005. And he comes over and he's like, hey, so you have a twin turbo 370Z sitting over here. What's it doing?
Oh, yes.
And yeah, so I was like, yeah, technically it is here and it is legal and capable of running. And so
it was only missing the fire suppression, right?
Yeah, fire suppression was the only thing it didn't have. I just have a regular extinguisher in that car. And so I was like, and then like Mike was like getting out of the car. He comes running over and he's, me and Mickey were already in the middle of talking. And I'm like, yep, like here's the deal. Like, car runs, it will work. It's obviously like not the most insane FD car. And he's like, we're just looking to qualify. Just want to throw a run down because, with our, licensed driver field, we have 32 drivers basically every event. So as long as you get around the course, you get points. And, he's like, I don't even plan on tandeming it. Like, we'll see how it goes. I'm like, I don't care about any of that, but, just whatever breaks, just fix it. Right.
Yeah, right.
You don't have to, pay me to rent a car or that's anything else. Right. It's just like, if you wreck into the wall, just help me make it look like it does now.
Right.
And so with that being said, he's like, oh, cool. Like, great. And so they take the car and, they start mounting up, his tires to, the wheels that I actually had in my trailer for the Infinity, for ride-alongs the next day at Pro Bro Down. And, he grabs the extra wheels off the other car and, they start mounting nittos to it. And, they're putting the car out, they mount their fire suppression and everything in there, and they're getting ready to go out on track. And FD comes over and, it is a rule. And so it's not to say they're beating down the little guy or, however you want to call it. But, so since he went out Friday morning and took his car onto the track, there is a rule that says that if you, whatever car you roll off the line with at any point in time on Friday, not Thursday, but Friday specifically.
Even practice.
Yeah. Because it limits the ability of people to bring spare cars.
Got it.
And so, because there was a point in time back in like 05, 06 where guys were bringing spare cars. And so if they wrecked a car right before qualifying, they had
Conrad
another one.
Had two cars with him all the time.
Well, there was a few, but
there was a couple people.
If your cars look identical, no one can tell the difference.
Yeah, and so it limited the ability of, if you wrecked a car in practice, to have another one just sitting idling ready to go. So just trying to keep costs down. So, it was a black and white rule. It's not exactly in the overall spirit of how it went down because we know that he just wanted to test it. He probably could have gotten the same, feel off of it in the burnout box, but, they just rolled over the line. Maybe just a misunderstanding on their end of the black and white rule, but, maybe another spotter saw it happening and called it out. I don't know, but, needless to say, it was an actual rule. So they denied him from entering the car, but it was, sitting on tires, fire suppression was in there, and he was ready to pull in line and
obviously
put the kibosh on.
It's very nice from you that you just let him use your, because I was like just your street car.
Yeah,
but it's still.
Said it was Jeff's car earlier, but it was your street car.
Yeah, no, but, it was the twin turbo car, so it was a brand new build, it was ready to go, and
So at a certain point, Vaughn could have borrowed your car to do Irwindale, even because his car was messed up. I mean, he could have done that, right? I mean, he could have said,
like, when you have Ford as your major sponsor.
I was going to say, the problem is, like, there's obviously not many, ready to go Formula Drift Fords, and Vaughn being such a, you know, Ford sponsored driver. Yeah. You know, he can't just go jump into a Nissan. It would, you know, more so.
He did have he hopped in and drive and goes, man, that Nissan's a piece of shit. I need to be back to my American muscle. And
I only qualify 15th. If I had a Ford, we'll qualify first.
Every time.
And
get a Ford.
Stupid Nissans.
Yeah. I know some of you guys might also think, well, Vaughn has like 20 Mustangs, which he doesn't have 20 as a couple, but those are demo cars and they're not FD legal. Like, you need to have a bunch of FD legal cages, safety, and maybe for a demo car to do sweet tandem shit, he like moved a mounting point for suspension that would be a very illegal modification for a Formula Drift car.
Yeah, it's not as easy as what some people think to just be like, why didn't you just jump in this? And because the FD rule book is so intricate that like I did build that twin turbo car specifically to be legal in the Formula Drift rule book, which is, you know, minus the fire suppression, but that's why like I built it that way so that if I ever did have to, I could. But that's not to say that every driver's spare car is FD legal.
Right.
Got it.
Well, that wraps it up.
Yep, that's about it.
Right. Do we want to hit some fan questions? Well, actually, hold on. Before we hit that, I wanted to ask, because we talked to...
Go ahead.
As I say, we talked to Jojo Hoho Man, John Hoyenga. That's the nickname I just made up.
And, Jojo Hoho.
And he was, he described to us, the power band differences in the VQ you're running a little bit. But what do you expect driving-wise to be different for you?
I mean, I'm definitely just looking to have more fun with it too. Like, I love turbo cars, obviously. Yep. I mean, everything minus my Infiniti that I have, the Datsun, the 240SX, my twin turbo car, they're all turbo because turbo cars are super fun. But up until very recently, and we can thank John Hoyenga over at Nameless Performance for this. The turbo cars weren't as I don't want to say not as drivable, but they weren't as responsive as a V8, of course.
Because you only have top-end boost, or you not only,
but... not to say top-end, but there's a small amount of delay in building boost. And so with a V8, you just have instant torque. And so that's why we were one of the first teams to put a V8 in our car back in 2005 for the 06 season. But, we stuck with that chassis and that engine package and developed it over the years, and it's been great. But, with switching teams and teaming up with Nameless Performance and Turk... like I said, John has fully developed an anti-lag system that is more advanced than almost anything I've ever seen. Mm-hmm. Because what's cool about Formula D is that we have this open power plant rule book. And the only thing that restrains us on making more power is ourselves to allow the car to have enough tire to last two laps.
Right.
And so like there's no reason, a lot of people talk about having like horsepower caps and everything else, but it's unnecessary because
the tires are the
limit. It doesn't matter if you make 600 or 1200 horsepower. It's about having the amount of grip that you need to be quick and have your tires last two laps. And so with that being said, the VK was great, and we had an awesome package with that. But John on the other end of the spectrum has been developing the anti-lag system that's like more advanced than most rally cars.
Yeah.
Because with the like I said, the lack of restraints on the power plants, and so going to the Nissan VQ or punching it out to a 4.2 liter with the Brian Crower kit, high compression JE pistons,
which we just learned before the show, it's not a VK 37, it's a VQ 37 to 42. So you're adding some more. It's more pops to the displacement,
as
they say in the business.
More bore end stroke, and so it's gonna be a 4.2 liter, which is a small V8 at that point. So that, and in conjunction with twin turbos from Garrett and the twin anti-lag system from Nameless, and also a little bit of nitrous sprinkled on top, I think it'll be just as drivable as our VK package was.
I like how you probably go into Nameless, like, hey, you're Turk's team, right? Cool.
Yeah.
It's like
you got the anti-lags, right?
No, you've got, so Turk's got one turbo, one anti-lag, I'll take two.
Like, I'm going to need a lot of that.
It's going to be twice as good.
Yeah, I need it to be twice as
good.
I've
seen you driving. You have a heavy foot. You killed yourself.
That's what John said to Forsberg, of course.
Yeah. That was the response immediately.
But drivability is obviously the power band is going to be a little bit different. but
is it the same chassis?
Same chassis, yeah. One bouncing off Irwindale a couple months ago.
Right.
That bounce at Irwindale, what did that do to your car?
It moved some stuff around, but it's
better back.
Yeah, it's all metal, and we were able to we cut some panels out, pulled it back straight over at Sam's Autoland, and you know, that thing is, yeah, I mean, it's just metal. It's just a car. We fix it up. It wasn't that catastrophic of a
just
crash.
Just a car?
Yeah, it's just a car. Well,
what, dude. Side note, what are you doing with your other Z?
Corey,
actually,
come on, you do sound desperate.
Yeah. No, I'm curious. Yeah. I'm curious.
No, it was it was and or is up for sale. Like, it's I had a guy that wanted to buy it and run it in this season, but they changed their plans last minute and they're running a different chassis. But
who?
Yeah.
Big mistake. Should have just bought
Mad car. Mike, we're sorry, dude.
Mad Mike. Yeah.
We know that your rotaries are really good motors. Yeah. And
no, this is good stuff because everybody's asking in a certain degree, well, what's happening with Jeff? How come you're not doing anything with the other Z? Like,
yeah,
this
no,
is what's happening on the internet.
What's
Sam.
Happening is that Forsberg dumps everyone
yeah,
he's ever
one,
loved.
One,
yeah, that's
heartbreak.
Yeah.
One and done. Forsberg
so,
like, done.
That one might be for sale or is for sale.
Yeah, like yeah, my second car is for sale, the one that Stoneback had driven. It's a mirror image of my right. championship winning car, still with the VK package and everything else. I still have it in my possession. We're going to do a couple like video shoots with it and yep. such, but yeah, I mean, you know, it's one of those Price is Right, it is available for sale type situation.
Nice.
I'm no longer planning on running two car team. You know, now that like I said before when you had asked about you know, the differences in our previous team years versus teaming up with Nameless. With Nameless, like we said, they're fully taking care of the FD program, and Turk will still be driving his FRS. So it's not
any myself. Responsibility on your part necessarily.
Yeah. And so, yeah, so it's not myself providing two cars, you know, and another driver to show up and have a ready-to-go chassis for him, and me having the, you know, the stresses of, you know, is the car good? Like, did something break? Is the right. engine okay? Like, you know, just always like, you know, like it was...
You're worrying about
concern.
Your shit.
Yeah,
this is your stuff too.
I mean, no, not even you know, worried about like the actual you know, tangible product, but you know, just how the other guy's doing. So like in between runs, be like on the radio, like, yeah, how's Jeff looking? You know, like this, that, and the other. Right. Just like asking, like, okay, like, you know, maybe tell him this or that, and just trying to like, you know, pass along some info and make sure he has the best chance that he has to do well.
Right.
But you know, like as we've seen that you know, we built a pretty fast and tight car, and it's adjustable, you know, for any other driver. But it's yeah, it's an animal. It's
right.
it's a hard car to handle. And yep. You know, they you know, Castro and Jeff both had great shining moments on certain tracks.
Yep.
Like Stoneback's most insane runs he's ever done
with
was against Osbo in Texas.
Texas.
That, yeah, was
that was
insane,
best.
Right?
Was
so so yeah, you can't say that you know, he wasn't adapting to that car.
Yep.
He was really
no, yep.
he was really fitting into that thing, and he was. You know, crushing, you know, Osbo on that track, and it looked awesome. He eventually won after the one more time, but it was awesome to see
yeah.
Jeff to hit that, you know, basically championship level driving.
Yeah,
you know, on that event,
Castro had a very good run against you.
Yeah, and same thing.
Both,
yeah.
Yeah.
yeah, and so yeah,
super
Castro
badass.
Had some
yeah, yeah.
some killer runs, and yeah, he almost put a hurting on us as well, and yeah, so he's Castro is now over at you know, Papadakis Racing, and you know, he's yep. he's loving that FRS
GT 86.
And he says that he likes the you know, the turbo four cylinder better than the V8. It's I mean, everyone has a preference,
right.
you know, and the thing is, you're not really going to know what your preference is unless you try everything, and
right.
so I mean, like, even Sam and I were talking yesterday about, you
two
know, the difference
being turbo motors.
Yeah, that's a direct quote.
no,
but yeah. No, we're talking about engine package for his car, and I was he was, you know, talking about, well, like, what do you think about 2J?
Cam.
And I was like, okay,
because the entire internet wants,
yeah, okay, Daigo.
The entire internet's like, get a 2J, you pussy.
Yeah, you need a 2J to go drifting, and yep. that's not
no
the
one,
case. You don't.
No one likes SRs anymore for whatever reason.
It's really weird.
I mean, mine blew up, so I
well,
hate them. But
yeah,
in my SR, when I built mine for my blue car, all you said was. Get a solid engine management,
yeah.
good injectors,
yeah.
and a good turbo, and you won't have to touch it ever again. I made
yeah.
like 360 wheel
yeah.
on a stock bottom end and put like 19 to 21 pounds of boost at it.
That's yeah. what I'm talking about.
Yeah,
and no issues.
But what we were
all.
Talking about with the Jay-Z and why I think you said you don't prefer them, he never said they're awful engines. He said
yeah.
they're great engines,
they're
but
great
boy,
engines.
He didn't prefer them was the weight compared to an SR for... I'm only trying to make 300 to 400 horsepower. If I'm trying to make 800, then you know maybe it might be a smarter idea to start
yeah,
with
like,
that other package. But for 400 horsepower, the weight of the Jay-Z makes your front end a little bit different to control, of course, but also
yeah.
maybe unnecessary.
And so for like an amateur style build versus a pro build, like yes, you know, a 2JZ and a pro car is a good choice because when you're building a pro car, you're doing everything you can to make it as efficient as possible. So you're moving all the way to the rear. You're getting, you know, everything as lightweight as possible up front. And you're using that 2J to make, you know, 800 to 1200 horsepower. But as like a, you know, an amateur drifter, to put a straight six iron block on the front end of your 240 with your rad and your intercooler and everything else on the front,
yeah,
and you know, gutting out your rear and having it super lightweight, it's not going to be a very fun drivable car. And you know, so when you're not hitting that level of utilizing a 2J to the max and, you know, moving that weight off the front into the back to, you know, even the car out, it's actually not that great of a handling car. And
right.
So for you, like with your 240, that's why I was recommending to stay with the SR, because it's a lightweight aluminum block, four cylinder up front, and you don't have to worry about, you know, just massive amounts of understeer and, you know, a real light rear end.
The good news is that I'm not very good at driving either way. So I probably won't be able to really utilize the quality of the build.
You did okay. You did okay.
Nah, you'll
as
love
I say,
it.
It's kind of incredible. What I think that might be an ongoing theme of the show is how shitty I built some of the parts of the car. Because not even intentionally, it's just that I'm bad at car.
You can't car.
You can't not car.
Yeah. Well, serious question, Chris.
Okay.
Okay, Paco.
Let's pretend. Let's get serious.
Let's say you have a Previa.
God damn it.
Right, here we go. Did you just call him out?
Yeah, he totally read my mind.
Yeah.
All right. So let's
say you have a very odd vehicle that resembles an egg. And you.
A dustbuster.
Yeah, exactly.
Nice.
And you don't want to use a factory four-cylinder engine because it sits sideways and it makes no power.
Mm-hmm.
And there's not a lot of room, so you're either going to have to find an engine that fits under the seat or...
Under the seat.
Under the seat.
Let's just say, does this Previa have a S14 rear end? Or no, not a Previa, excuse me. Whatever this car
Previa.
Is. Whatever car this is.
Oh, this imaginary vehicle.
He's asking for a friend.
Yeah. I'm asking for a friend. And you either put something that fits under the seat...
That's it.
Or you have to cut and make room for any other engine. What would you do? Like, what do you think will be the best way?
For a friend.
I would burn that van to the ground.
God damn it. Serious question, Forsberg.
Serious answer, dude.
What is your friend trying to get out of this build?
He just wants to make like a fun car to go on bashes and.
I like how Paco starts up with
250 to 300 horsepower.
Where does the engine sit in the car?
Right now, it's under the seat.
Well, okay, so we say under the seat, but I mean in the like the weight fulcrum. Like,
technically considered a mid-engine.
Yeah, I was gonna say it's behind the front axle, right?
Yeah.
I mean, like. And with that, you know...
But it still has plenty of room.
Yeah, I bet it is.
To go.
it's
very
good.
Long wheelbase.
Yeah, I mean, you could definitely do a bigger motor with that. Like, a lot of people don't take into consideration, you know, where an engine is placed in a vehicle, and they just buy whatever mount kit they can find and stick whatever motor they think is cool in the car. But, you know, the further forward that weight is over your front axle, the worse that car is going to handle, which is why you see a lot of guys trying to, you know, move motors back and move them lower, you know, and that's why, you know, even specifically, you know, cars like the TC are successful because it's, you know, they stuck with the four-cylinder for the exact reason that, yes, they could put a 2J in that thing, mm-hmm. but they wanted the, you know, the lightweight four-cylinder to be, you know, further back and keep the weight off that front end. And if they put a 2J in the front of that car, it would not be as good as it is.
And honestly, that the motor has been indestructible for Osbo, like just ran the entire season.
Yeah.
And, solid.
Yeah, exactly. So like, yeah, for all the people like, why don't you just put a 2J in there? Like, yeah they clearly are dealing with the woes of that engine because of that, you know, that drivability.
But yeah, there's choices that are made, and also the 2J is now, not that there's not new technology and shit coming out for it. But
I know we're just specifically talking about the 2J, but you know, that's just the example.
Yeah, that's the example, but also just in comparison to like a VQ, like not just because you're keeping with a Nissan engine package and mm-hmm. even the Nissan engine that came in the car, which is cool, but the VQ37 is a few-year-old design now.
Yeah, it is, for sure.
The J, like 1J, 2J engine block style and all that stuff is now 25, 30 years old. Like,
I mean, it's 23 years old.
And that's not to say that you can still make massive power out of there, but just the engine design, engine weight, cooling and oil.
Dave Briggs has had it. What he was making, like 850 horsepower.
Ah, dude, VQs.
No, on his SR20.
Oh, on the SR.
Solidly, for 3 years.
Still 25-year-old engine design. Though I'm just saying, using a modern engine in a car. At least we're not talking about my car anymore.
I'm not talking about my friends.
Your friends.
My friends' car.
What we're saying is get a twin turbo nitrous anti-lag VQ and put it in there.
Yeah, right. There you go. That's going to do the trick.
Tell, but, tell your friend.
But yeah, I mean, that's another reason why we're going with the VQ is because, you know, with the VQ, it's a V6, and so it's very short, which is nice. And so we can have a lot of that weight where we want it to be. And, you know, like we're talking about with, you know, an engine like the 2J, like, yes, it's great at making horsepower, and that's mostly because of, I don't want to say mostly, but a large variable of that is because it has that iron block.
Right.
And so it's a very strong block. It can hold a ton of power. And but, you know, with that comes the weight. And, you know, obviously the straight six being, you know, you get that very long front end weight.
Right.
So with us, you know, the VK was great, but we had that thing just shoved all the way back against the firewall as best we could, trying to keep that weight off the front end. But
yeah,
the VQ is going to be an even better package. But with the twin turbos and twin anti-lags, it's going to almost even out to what the VK was.
I didn't even really think about this, but, you know, a 2J coming stock in a SC and a, what do you call an SC, a SOAR in Japan? I don't know.
Yeah.
But the Supra and a SOAR, it sits so far back in that car because they have a huge hood and a huge front end, and it just sits so far back in the middle of the car, which is how they dealt with that weight, I'm sure. Yep. And then you think of that in an S14, or you think of that in whatever other car, and it's sitting probably a lot further forward than the original Toyota designers intended that engine to sit.
Yeah, exactly. And I mean, even for another just random example, like look at like a Datsun, like when they used to run a straight six versus
hold on,
you talking to Siri?
I don't know what's my phone, Apple. Well, I don't know what the hell they're doing. Like Siri has been coming.
Hey,
up.
Hey Siri, what did Sam search for last on Google?
Oh god. I mean, his is great though.
That's
when you actually say, hey Siri, it doesn't come up, but then like I look down and somehow in that conversation we're having, it thought that I said Siri at some point, and then it got
Siri
all the words wrong.
Under the Siri.
Oh, hey Corey, you're here.
Nailed it. I've just been eavesdropping over here, checking IG,
just hanging.
Tough. A lot of stuff's been going wild.
Good.
There.
Oh, we got the kids riled up. They want to ask some facts.
Yeah, some of the questions have been they're pretty wild.
Can I start with a quick one, real quick?
A quick one.
Quick question from our buddy Keith Johnson.
Oh, God.
If you can read that one, please.
Furiousberg is the man, though. Way better than Corey. What's his name? Plus, he has a running car, so that helps. Kissy face.
He's got a running car.
Do you think which car is going to run first, mine or Corey's?
Probably yours.
Dang.
That was a great
It's a good one.
Well, I'm so glad we read that one. That was
Siegberg.
Let's cancel all questions now. We're done. So good.
I've got a really good one. click for likes _ 776136059 says, want followers.
And then check my page.
And the follow-up question was check my page.
Good question, Chris. What do you think?
Bad question. Bad news.
Okay. you want to read this one, Chris?
What do we got?
Grape ape.
4P. When will we get to see the 510 wagon with the Forsberg touch? So yeah, like, another little tidbit that we dropped out recently was the, 510 that I'm going to be building. It's going to be a more or less a street car. It's not going to be a psycho drift car or anything of the sort. I'm not going to put a V8 or, you know, any sort of big turbo engine in the front of that thing.
The intent is kind of so your wife can drive it around.
Yeah, that's the plan. So like, you know, I have my Datsun and I'm building one for her. And you know, she loved my car and we got mine together to have like a cool little daily driver. And then I ruined it.
Wait, which car was that? The Datsun.
The Datsun. Okay. Yeah, the 280Z.
Yep.
And now she's like afraid to drive it, not because of the power, but because
it's like a SEMA.
She doesn't want to curb the wheels or break the front lip off. And so,
right. Understandable.
You know, I was like, well, how about this? Let's do a 510 wagon. Let's do something totally different. And so it's cool. It's going to be, like I said, a simple build. It's going to be like a street scraper, for lack of better words.
But she doesn't want to scrape.
I'm going to take care of that. Yeah. And so we got some plans for it, but it'll look cool and it'll keep, true to that, classic Japanese car culture theme.
Static or bags?
Maybe bags.
Oh,
ooh. Yeah, so Mitch is gonna be flipping switches, maybe.
Yeah.
Hell yeah! It's all that.
How else do you get the best
LA
of both worlds?
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, I gotta go with the LA thing, you know.
Yeah.
Cool.
Ooh, this is a good one.
Uh-oh.
Tapped by Sway says, "Baha ha ha ha! You guys are dorky and cute. Good question.
That's
thank you.
Awesome.
Yeah, thanks. Wow. Great.
That's cool.
Edward Thompson says, Chris, how do you do it and why do you do it? I think we covered that.
That was the opening question.
That was the opening question.
Wow.
That's a tough one.
Ooh, here's a good one. Jules of Proper Line says, why do you look 12?
Whoa, that's good.
You look like a 12-year-old with a fat beard.
I was going to say a bearded 12-year-old. That sounds awkward.
I mean, I guess we don't need to answer that.
Yeah. I think we handled that one.
This is a good one from Tall Ginger 32. Yeah. You're also a tall ginger,
yeah,
Chris.
There you
That's
go.
Fun.
Yep.
Yeah.
And I'm also 30.
Well, you can't, you have to call it ginger.
Ginger?
Yeah. Yeah.
What does that mean?
I don't know.
Ginger is offensive. You know, the ER is like a.
Oh, Jesus, Paco.
Paco.
Ginger.
He says, what is your favorite non-Nissan car?
That's a tough one.
That's a good one. I like it.
Yeah.
Which he's not actually contractually allowed to say. It's part of his deal with
Nissan. Moving along. No, it's hard to say, but if I had to choose, I got to be a part of the BMW M initiation video.
Yeah,
so
I
got to drift around a brand new M4 around a lot of 60
other cars,
different BMW M's. And that car was a ton of fun. It was very, very sweet. It's a twin turbo V6.
Hey, on that shoot, were you nervous at all drifting around all these classic M's?
Actually, no.
Cool. Cool. Smooth operator. Were the owners of the cars and were the production team nervous?
They were probably nervous, yeah.
How about one from XX Bieber Bay 420XX?
There he is.
Ah, Bieber Bay.
Yeah. Who looks better in a bikini, Audie or Jared?
Asking for a friend. I mean, I haven't seen Odie in a bikini.
Odie would probably look more feminine.
I think Odie probably has a tighter figure.
Yeah. What makes you say that?
But that doesn't mean better in a bikini.
Right.
Like maybe, you know, smaller is not always better.
Yeah.
So I would say Jared.
Jared can probably fill a bikini better.
He would fill a bikini better. So I guess it
fill us in like full.
It really depends on what you're looking for.
Yeah.
out of your men wearing bikinis.
Tell your friend.
Roman
relay
to your friend. Roman Junggut says, who is the most underrated driver in FT?
Ooh.
I was just going to ask that. Good one, Sam.
Underrated. Yeah. That's
like
tough.
In this season?
Sorry, Corey, I stole that.
No, it's good.
I can
tell you what
Chris
mine was.
Blues.
Yes, that's a good one.
Yeah.
And originally, back in the day, one of my favorite drivers was actually Kenny Moen.
Kenny Moen is a psycho, yeah.
He was one of my favorites first getting in.
Yeah, he's super fast and good. I'd say as of now, Kristaps Bluse is the most underrated driver.
Which is crazy because he is definitely, you could say, quote unquote, rated. He's considered a good driver, but
he's still kind of floating under the radar.
Yeah,
right, you know,
he definitely doesn't get enough credit as he should for the maniac that he is.
Because he can't throw down. He's very consistent already, and then sometimes he throws down these Daigo follow runs,
dude,
you know, Daigo 2012
he throws down like the gnarliest runs.
But
and,
it's not Daigo.
Take a deep breath, Kristaps, and you will wreck everybody.
As I say, it's not Daigo-esque in that he's just on and off following but he's a smooth, close following.
Yeah.
Quick parenthesis. You guys heard about Kenny Moen?
He's done.
Kenny Moen's
announced
out.
His last that mm-hmm. he's not doing FD.
Well, he stopped. He didn't show up to every round this last season because he was off filming Ferrari commercials or whatever.
he was driving a Lamborghini and some other thing or a Ferrari. Yeah. But he's obviously got some cool things going on in Europe.
Here's more of a statement than a question for you, Forsberg. This is Cuckoo for Cookies. Chris, my first FD experience was Irwindale 07 with passes thanks to Alex Pfeiffer. By the end of the event, you were my favorite driver. I managed to grab one of your used Maxxis tires. And this year will mark the 10 years since I took that thing home. If I bring it to Irwindale this year and track you down, will you sign up for me? Please. I love everything you do for the sport. Keep on killing the game.
That's
kind of cool.
Bro.
That's kind of cool, huh?
Yeah.
He's had a tire sitting in his living room for 10 years.
I was just going to say, and kudos to your girlfriend for allowing that stinky tire to stay in your house for 10 years.
Think about all the excuses he has. No, it's a spur.
I'm waiting for, Irwindale 2017.
Just save that thing.
Yeah. And also the answer is unfortunately no. it's not
Thanks,
a handcuff.
I didn't want to say that. That's awesome.
That's
cool. Irwindale 07 was a pretty gnarly event. That was like I said, my first year running as a privateer, but you know, I was we're building and running our own car. It was very small amount of sponsors, and that was when we went out. We finished second place overall. We're actually like running through the season off of contingencies because we had very little partnerships to start the year. We barely had enough to get out to Atlanta and back.
When you say contingencies, define
off of wins. Yeah.
So we were only getting paid off of winning.
Yeah, we It was one of those, 2007, and we didn't know, well, we did not have enough money to run the year, hands down. And so we ran Long Beach. It was an okay event, and I went out to the winner of that round, and then we get out to Atlanta, and we actually won. And so, you know, we got a nice chunk of change, and so that kind of helped pay the way to get to the next round. And ended up winning two rounds that year, and two wins, one podium, and finished second place overall in the event. And Irwindale, yeah, it was a killer event.
For those that don't understand how contingencies work, it's like if one of your sponsors wants to sweeten the deal a little bit, they say, Forsberg, if you win the round, we'll give you $1,000 bonus or $500 bonus, which is like AM with us. They're like, hey, if you can go an entire episode without cursing, we'll give you another air filter.
This event's out.
Yeah, to say, another whole episode down. We can't do it. Corey, I know you want to read it.
It's just some of these I just can't help but to laugh at.
I know which one you want to read, so why don't you just knock it out.
No, this one's from Bradford the Fish. Did you see that one, Sam?
I did not yet.
All right, this is from Bradford the Fish.
Fire away.
So how did Ryan get to team up with you? Did he pay you, or was it some Willy Wonka golden ticket bullshit? Also, do you think Turk will ever be as skilled as your ex-partner, Corey?
Hey.
My favorite part was like, or did he do some Willy Wonka golden ticket bullshit?
Yeah.
By the way, this is one of the kids we talked to.
He's
so if you guys don't remember the contest last year.
Good job, buddy.
Yeah, I mean, I wish more people entered, but yeah, I guess Turk was the only one. Yeah.
But he's the one who sang, by the way.
Bradford the Fish was the young kid at the end that was
sang with you guys.
Yeah. Bradford has a bright future in journalism. Yeah,
he did it while handstanding in with one hand.
Oh yeah, that's right.
That's right.
So
I remember that.
Chris, if you don't mind, can you address this?
Answering that question. Circling way back to earlier in this podcast when we started to talk about it and quickly got sidetracked with another story. I've known Turk since 2003. We actually met at one of the very first Club Loose events when we started running those events out of Englishtown, before FD even started or existed. And so we were doing those events, and Turk immediately was a cool guy and down with the crew and became
immediately.
One of our,
let's be honest.
Yeah.
Right away.
Yeah. Like he showed up and he had a KA powered S13, and we're like, holy shit, this dude rips.
Oh hell yeah.
And and then the funny part was he had his twin brother who was also drifting at the time, and
you made the old Turk switcheroo.
Yeah. And so like one of like the next events, like you know, his brother showed up and we're like, hey, what's up, man? And he's like, who are you guys? And it was super weird, and we had no idea what was going on.
Sam has a similar story like that.
Yeah.
I think if you're a twin, I think the first thing if you meet anyone, be like, so just so you know, I have a twin.
Yeah, which was never, they don't do. Yeah. Either out of just, they're not very courteous, or they just want to see people struggle. Yeah.
Or get some sort of branding tattoo on your forehead.
Yeah. Number one.
Some sort of label.
Number two. It causes a lot of confusion.
It does.
The tattoo of a tear.
Yeah, is that what that means? A tear means
two tears,
a twin.
That's how you identify. Yeah, if I have
that
like
means you kill
tier.
Someone in jail, right?
Yep.
Okay, good.
Come on, Paco.
I'm sure Ryan's brother, which... Does Evan kind of hang out at Formula Drift?
Yeah, Evan's actually part of the team. Yeah,
I'm sure he loves that when he walks through the pits. I'm sure at least
I hope he milks
5
the
to 20
shit out
times
of it.
A day people are like, Ryan, and he's like, I wonder how he, I haven't seen it. Does he, does
well,
he
Evan,
take
Evan's
it?
Not the twin. Justin's the twin.
I know he's not the twin twin, but he still looks very much like him. Yeah. And Justin does go to some FD events, I think. He's been around once or twice.
Yeah.
He is nearly indistinguishable unless you've known the Turks for a long time.
Yeah. It's amazing. I've done it before. But
it's their fault.
Yeah, so we met in 2003 and started doing some stuff together with Drift Alliance, and he was one of the aces and before we like actually, you know, had him fully involved with Drift Alliance the next couple years. But 2005 he came to Chicago. I think it was his first Formula D event, and like we're trying to like, you know, help him in little ways. And 2006 he had a pretty good car situation with a sponsor from the northeast. But at that point we were already talking about trying to figure out how to do two car team, and I had my V8 convertible, and we're trying to figure out a way to get him in my SR powered hardtop 350Z. And so
it's only taken you 10 years to
Only taken 10 years for us to actually get a two car team going. But there's been many small, passings in the night, you know, however you want to call it, like
ships passing in the night. That's a very poetic way to
exactly. So like, you know, like you come into an off season and it's like, you know, not to say that it's been a goal for 10 years, but it's been, you know, brought up it's multiple also, times. And so the timing lined up and it's great. And so
it's been 1 week.
Teaming up.
Since it's been 1 week since
I got this is kind
of. No, but hold on. I need to answer the second half.
What's the second half?
Will Turk, do you think Tarek will ever be as skilled as your ex-partner, Corey Hosford?
At eating bowls of spaghetti? Absolutely not.
That's well, never. True.
What about,
I'll accept
what about car wheels?
Car wheels, I mean, his stick out way further than Turk's, actually.
Oh, yeah.
Advantage
story. He's
got a long
actually
stroke
got a bit of a beat
wheel.
Up. Yeah.
So this is another question. Actually, I really enjoy this question because I've now reading it, I'm really wondering about
Uh-oh.
It.
Uh-oh.
This is from Jay Selner.
We're getting
serious. How can we have a cool nickname for your car like Chair Slayer's Finger Flicker? How can we not have a nickname for your car? Do you?
I don't.
Some drivers just don't do it.
Do you have a weird. Name for your
well,
Infiniti?
Blanca.
Yeah, the Flama Blanca
which,
has a name.
Which is now...
Now it's that's the black
one. Flama Negra. So what's behind that color change?
Just want to change it up. That car's been white, La Flama Blanca, since 2011 when I first built it, and so
every other car you have is black now, though. So.
Yeah. So I wanted to just kind of fit more along in the theme, and it was cool having a car that was different. But I'd go to events and
people would get mad.
Yeah. They would.
It would be like people would literally not be able to make the connection because they're like, "What's this big white four door?" And like, as much as I liked it looking like that,
hey guys,
like,
I'm Chris
there
Forsberg.
Was no connection. They're like, "No, you're not, you dork.
No, you drive a black car. You stupid.
he drives a Z.
Yeah,
dummy.
You're stupid."
So So I just wanted to fit more in lines with the twin turbo car and and the pro car.
So, is there a future for a nickname for your car?
I think it's important.
Why don't you
sleep on it?
Can we name it?
Let's sleep on it.
We can name the car. Or we have a competition to name
ask,
Forsberg's
ask
car.
Ask people to comment.
Yeah, throw her in the comments.
Call his 70Z.
No, I think if we actually do that, we should do a real competition.
If they can pick a car name, they'll get a filter.
Yep.
That'd be cool.
Oh, we actually, I just realized that by the end of this episode, we should probably choose the winner of the first filter.
Right.
There you go. AM filter? You guys give out AMs?
AM stuff, dude.
That's cool, man.
Signed AM filter. We're going to just have it signed by us, but now that you're here, maybe, I guess we could pop
real
one.
Real value.
All right. Let's get to a couple more questions.
Let's see.
Iron Dookie, he has a question.
Who's that?
Never heard of him. He said, how confident are you in your new pro car setup? And are you confident enough that you get a picture of Corey Hosford tattooed on you if you place lower than third in the championship?
Jesus
Christ, these guys are just animals. Just letting you know, we had a group chat before this Q&A,
I mean, like, we've had a pretty good run, but I mean, placing in the top three is a serious challenge,
right?
And so, like, obviously that's always the goal, and we've succeeded that numerous times.
I'd say it's a win-win, really, though.
Yeah. I mean, sounds like it. I can keep my best bud by my side forever.
Well, do you remember when we were going to Texas and Dustin tattooed your replica Forsberg tattoo on my back with the Sharpie?
Yeah, that's right.
I still have a video of that one. We did a replica, me and Dustin, when we were driving to Texas. We tried to replicate all Forsberg tattoos on my body with a Sharpie.
It turned out great.
Yeah, actually, it was Fosback because Dustin forgot to put the R in. I have video. We'll find the video and I'll post it.
Good.
There's one from Huckleberry 51. You want to read this one, Chris?
What was the name?
Why?
Paco?
Because
Huckleberry.
Can you read Paco? Yeah.
Nah,
you've been having me read all your questions here.
Well,
I'll see.
You
Chris is the guest.
Then.
We gotta respect Chris.
Come on. I mean,
attention, Chris Forsberg.
Attention.
What is your favorite Star Wars movie or cartoon, and why? I'm only your fan due to the X-wing fighter pilot suit helmet. And the Drift Alliance, like Rebel Alliance. Also, I'm a non-freckled ginger.
Rise up, brother.
Yeah. Well, it's good to hear I have a fan based directly on a suit that I did not design. Thanks, Andy LaBucca.
Yep.
Wait, which suit is this?
The X-Wing suit. That's what he said.
Yeah.
He says, I'm only your fan because of your X-Wing
suit. I didn't know that Andy designed
and
that.
And the helmet.
It was a combination effort. I think Lindsay Ross was involved in that and Andy LaBucca.
Was that the brown one with the brown streak down?
It was the old
brown,
brown
streaker,
right down the back.
What came up first?
I added that after Long Beach.
did you lock down that license plate that I saw a picture of? I don't want to say it in case someone steals it.
Oh yeah.
So which car is that for?
The Datsun.
Yeah. So the Datsun now has a license plate that says Gold Leader, which is
what is it?
Nice.
Gold Leader. Star Wars reference.
Oh,
never.
Yeah.
I know you've
so
never
I know
seen
all
Star
the Star
Wars.
No, I know all of them now.
What happened first? A nickname?
I got a special plate that's 17 characters long.
Yeah.
Oh, nice.
Gold leader.
Yeah.
So, yeah, what happened first? The nickname, the Force,
or
the
nickname.
Fan?
Yeah.
So
yeah.
You weren't really a Star Wars fan?
I've always been a fan.
But
no,
I remember.
I've always been a fan, and Jared drummed up the Force Forsberg sometime in 2010, 2011. And I first started wearing that X-Wing suit with the matching helmet in 2012 and then into 2013.
Because I remember there was a photo, I don't know what's the context of that photo, where you and a bunch of, I think the other Drift Alliance guys are like looking at a computer, but you're wearing like an Obi-Wan.
That was for Wrecked Magazine. We had a bunch of people over at my house back in 2009, I want to say, maybe 10. And it was like just us huddled around a computer. It was like for a cover of Wrecked.
Nice.
It's pretty funny.
You look like a Jung Padawan.
Yeah.
Jung
Padawan.
Anything else?
Anything else on there worth reading, dog?
There's got to be some other ones.
Well, there's tons. It's just like hard.
Well, I got a question outside of this. Uh-oh. And I want.
This is from.
Who's this from?
This is from Sausage Drinker 3.
yep.
When you did
who's Sausage Drinker 1 and 2? These guys?
Yeah, there's dang three it of us. In Long Beach on the noose, when you ended up spinning out.
Oh, that was the best.
Yeah, what? Like, the track was shitty, obviously.
You guys want to talk about that?
I want to know about it. Like, because I've done way worse shit than that. It's really not that bad.
That was one of my crowning
on
moments.
TV?
Yeah, so it was. The news here's the rundown for all the people that love that video and the audio that goes along with it. Professional drivers, precision coming through, never makes mistakes, blah blah blah.
Right.
And the short version of that story, or the behind the scenes version, would be, it's top me off, Paco. Let's finish this off strong. So it's Thursday, form of drift, and the news station's talking to FD, or FD's talking to them, you know, either way. And so they're like, yeah, we want to do a quick live segment to kick off the event. And they're like, we want you, Turk, Osbo, Gucci to start it off, right?
Well, real quick, why don't you think they picked Farouk or the dude driving Forces S13?
because the four of us all crashed ourselves, and so
they originally had asked June to come out of retirement to do it.
The infamous June NATO on the front straight.
So the best part of this whole thing, right, is this was the best worst display of Formula Drift on TV of all time. And so what I mean by that is, so they ask us, right? It's was there a fifth guy? No, I think it was just the four of us. No, Vaughn was out there too. Yeah. So they asked, these top five guys to come out and do a quick, 10-minute back and forth, forward course, counter course through the FD section in the absolute pouring rain, right?
Yep.
Oh, my God.
And no one had been out on the track yet. It's first thing Friday morning, and it's like, okay, like, no practice, no feeling
outside
out
of media day. There was no, this is,
well, yeah,
all
media
there
day was fully dry. And so we all just like, we do quick rain setups on our car, and it's, like I said, it's live. So it's not like, okay, let's ease out into practice. Let's feel out where the slick spots are and sort this out. It's like, okay, live, you five go,
go for it.
Yeah. Go for it. And so it was a discussion. We had a quick talk of, who's going to go first? What's the order? And it's and I was like, fine, I'll do it.
Oh,
I'll go
beast
first. And so I go down, I line up first, and the other guys are behind me. I come out through first turn. I'm like, all right, not so bad. We're doing okay.
Oh,
you know, this is good. And then transfer back. I'm like, okay, still going. All of a sudden, and it just like
it's
goes
not going
out. And so the Long Beach course, it's the streets of Long Beach, but turn 9, 10, and 11, which is our former Drift 1, 2, and 3, is actually through a parking lot.
Yep.
And so the judges' wall, that wall that we all kind of push out and scrape along, is perpendicular to about 15 parking spots.
Yep.
And if you've ever been to a parking lot after the rain, you see all the rainbow puddled up, or in the dry you see all the black spots
right
from all the cars dripping oil,
which is
so
Jesus smiling on you. That's what the rainbows mean.
That's Jesus smiling down on you.
Jesus.
He was definitely smiling on me that day.
Oh, for sure he was.
He was like, watch this, you sucker.
Got him.
And so we transfer through, and as what became a very reoccurring event throughout the rest of that day is you transferred.
But you were the first.
I was the absolute first. And live on the news, and they just kept that camera rolling after I did that.
Well, do you know what I would have done, Forsberg? I would have went back to Turk and Vaughn and be like, no, the track's good. Forsberg just killed it. You guys are good.
Yeah, you guys are set.
Ten tenths.
No. So let me get to that. That's the best part, because the camera's kind of like stayed on me. And then like after I crashed, they kind of cut. I don't know exactly what happened because I wasn't watching. I just saw my clip. But from what I heard, they didn't really film much of the other driving because they didn't know what was going to happen. And so I you know, hit the back end of my car, and you know, like FD cars, we you know, bounce off walls.
Right.
I did a quick 180 and got out of the way because another car was coming. And we went through, and I actually like had to go and drift back and forth again still. And so we did all that. But right after me, Turk went, crash into the wall.
Yep.
Gucci went, crash into the
Every
wall.
Every single
Vaughn
person.
Went, crash into the wall. And then Osbo went and blew his motor.
Really good.
All five cars didn't make it through the run.
Really good representation of our sport for the lay people that don't watch drifting.
But since I was the idiot that was like, fine, I'll go first, I got to be that amazing reference of Formula Drift spinning backwards in the rain.
You sure set the bar for everybody.
Set the precedence of the weekend.
I think it's amazing.
Do it like that, guys. Do it like that. And there were more wrecks in that Friday morning practice than any Formula Drift practice ever. And that's why they decided to go off of rank for qualifying.
Which is pretty sweet for you, because last year you did pretty well.
Third previous year.
Yeah. So it,
do you know, that's it went off rank of 2015.
Do you know what really though?
Right.
It just wasn't a good representation of driving. There were 32 drivers, and we're like,
were so shitty.
There was a quick talk, and I know a lot of people are like, oh man, these guys can't even drive in the rain. But like, it wasn't the rain, because we've driven in the rain in tons of events, in competition, everything
the
else.
Entire season.
But on properly prepped, you know, tracks. And so like Road Atlanta, we qualified in the rain. Orlando or Miami, we had to do qualifying passes in the rain. Orlando, we've driven in the rain.
Whole
We've driven in the rain on many, many tracks.
Right.
And that's
so
just
unpredictable.
The thing. But the situation with Long Beach being through that parking lot, it was just completely terrible conditions. And it was more of a crapshoot than it was driving skill. So they decided that since the next day was fully dry conditions, let's prevent future damage to all these cars that are doing their best to qualify and just have a good show for Saturday.
I did come up with an idea though.
Go for it.
You know, and we can all split the money off of this that it makes. But I got an idea.
Did you run it by the owner of Formula Drift?
No, we'll change the name. We're gonna call it Formula Drenched. But
oh, good one.
Hey.
So Sam, you're gonna be the producer with me on this.
Sure.
So the thing is, we're going to go pitch this movie to like Disney and like all these other large companies, but it's a story about a young race car driver who almost totals his car first run of the day and comes back with a successful story of winning the championship.
Right.
And turn it into like a 2-hour long movie.
Sure. I love it.
You know, emotions were down, thought he was down and out, never going to win anything.
It's animated,
don't
right?
Stand
yeah,
a
it's animated. Yep. Yeah, it's all hand drawn by Paco.
But isn't the and then the climax of the story is when it's Formula Drift Irwindale and then DZ the Dragon.
Yeah.
DZ the Drift Dragon comes and eats your car into the wall.
Yeah, and just throws you right into the wall.
Yeah, and then
so it was a real bookend type of year.
Yeah.
So we
started in the wall, ended in the wall.
Started strong, ended strong.
That was my idea, guys. So that's
I'd say we pitch that idea and we pitch a tent.
We'll pitch a tent
right outside the offices until that does happen. We're actually
just when you think he's down and out.
A dragon comes and pushes his car into the wall.
And then ass backs the wall at her window.
Let's start with in a world where the drifting starts.
It's actually not bad. Like that's a Mexican version of the voice guy.
Can you do that in Spanish?
En el mundo donde el drifting encuentra en peligro de extinción.
I'll do it.
He said
in a
world where Corey eats spaghetti.
I cannot wait until the Patreon goal where Paco can only speak Spanish an entire episode.
Yes, I know. I can't wait for that.
That is my goal for sure.
We have one more question.
Hold on. Another question.
Just
another question. So when you get top 16, right, and you come out.
Who's this question from?
This is from Huey Lewis and the TV show.
The Hot Wheels.
Yeah. So when you get called out for top 16, and your Drift Alliance friends, they always cruise out three breaths all the way around, you know, being selfish, hogging the whole show.
Wait, three breaths?
Right.
We call that the total recall. Yep.
So Vaughn, you know, he gets called up and he does the hat cowboy twirly lasso thing. And then you open the door and stand on your door and give a big cheers, right? How come? Have you ever thought about changing that routine?
I haven't stood on my door in a very long time. So
what do you do? I used to
run up the back and stand on the cage of my convertible.
Right. And then you ran. You used to climb the fence or jump on the fence, right?
No, I've only done the fence if we win.
Okay.
Yeah.
Have you ever thought about making a new routine? Because Sam and I came up with a few for mine.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I remember that you
got to have it ready. You don't want to be coming up with it on the spot.
You did tell me that you and Turk, if you make it out in top 16 together, you're going to do Ring Around the Rosie.
Yeah.
Our Red Rover with the camera guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, we're going to come out. We're going to put a pole in the ground. We're going to grab our little laces and spin around in circles.
Do you know what I'm going to do for top 16? Have you ever told you?
Let's hear it.
All right. Sam, do you want to break
the news? So the more or less idea is that Corey's got a suit pocket, right?
Assuming he made it on top 16.
Right.
He's going to make every top.
But this is more motivating for me than actually winning a trophy.
When they're going down the line announcing people, he's going to have a pocket full of sausages.
Hot dogs.
He's going to take a fat bite out of one when they call him.
Yeah, and I'm going to huck it into the crowd.
That's good.
But I want to have a pocket full of hot dogs and then just
he's going to rally around the family with a pocket full of hot dogs. Thanks for that question, Huey.
Yeah.
Huey lives in the TV show. Thanks for that.
But yeah, if you and Turk don't coordinate some shit, you're messing up.
Yeah.
We'll do our best.
The best 16 intro last year was it last year or the year before? What the fuck is that guy's name? He brought out the big ear.
Oh, Kenji.
Yeah, Kenji Yamanaka.
That was not last year or the year before,
that was 2 years.
Dude. That was like 2009.
That's got to be like 6 years ago.
I still remember that.
This guy.
Wait,
Corey, what year did you first go out and watch Formo Drift?
Second event ever, Houston.
Yeah, what year was that?
Red Line, that was 2004 or 3.
Okay, that's better.
Previously, yeah.
You're like, 2002 or 2003. I was like, man, I wonder why Corey was out in the Reliance Center before FD existed.
Yeah, no, 2000. It was one of those years. I don't remember. It was the second event ever at FD.
Yeah, no,
but
I know.
That was I still remember that, and I think that's such a cool opportunity to
bring out a foam ear.
To do anything you want. to do anything you want. Think about you have the spotlight on you for 10 seconds to do whatever you want.
Well, we used to do those awesome intros, like per driver.
And you can do your song.
Yeah. You play a song.
Are you ready for this?
Yeah. No, but we had some fun with that in the past.
I would love for that to come back.
Well, hopefully, Corey, I mean, the hot dog one is just going to be one round. And then
we're going to have hot dog nunchucks.
We're going to have seven.
Hot dog nunchucks. Are they tied together with spaghetti?
Yep, just loop it around.
We're going to whip it one time and it just flies off.
I get pissed at it, stomping on the ground.
We're going to have to do a large plan of possible top 16
intros. I'm telling
you,
that's what I look forward to more than anything. Like, literally, I can go back to the pits and load it up and just go. But, yeah, I just can't wait for that.
All right, we have one more question. My mom had a question.
All right.
Do you want to come over here and
go ahead,
blast
mom.
That? Come
oh,
come on.
Yeah. She's been raising her hand for the past hour.
She's been up doing over here.
I cannot believe that you've been ignoring her this whole time.
That's what it was.
All right, so talk very close to the mic. Right. What your question was?
Okay, my question for
talk Mr. Mom.
My question for Mr. Forsberg.
She sounds just like Sam.
Forsberg is. I want to know what color you're going to paint Mish's car.
Yeah. Oh.
Whoa.
Oh no. I'm embarrassed to say, and I do know.
I don't know what it is.
You don't?
I mean,
there used to be a Datsun 510, but what is a 510?
That's a great question.
Yeah, Datsun 510.
Don't tell Chris to shut up. You shut up, Mom. It's great question. First time, Mom. Second time.
Second time
question. Yeah. All right, so.
What is a 510?
What is a 510? Because I'm asking for a friend.
What are 4510?
What was your Instagram? What's your mom's Instagram name?
DriftBomb52, right?
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah.
If you wanna, just send her nice things.
Just be nice.
So what's a 510
what
and what color
510?
Are you gonna paint it?
510 was a early Nissan.
Datsun. You peasant. God.
That's why I said.
Dude, nice job. Finish
my thought. This early Nissan, actually Datsun, because not everyone knows what Datsun is. Most do, but. Yes.
Fact checker Sam.
So it's a Datsun that is comes in a coupe, four door, or wagon. We went with a wagon because it's just it's a little different than what most people build. Most people stick
cool.
with the coupes. Yeah, it's cool. And if you're gonna build a cool little street car, I think doing something that's different, like especially like a wagon. And what color are we going to paint it? I don't know. It's currently yellow. And I like it because it kind of fits in with the Datsun already as being gold. But I don't know. I think Mitch has her eyes set on another color, so we'll see.
Nice. Yeah. And it was the 510 considered like a sporty car when it came out? What kind of car was it?
I mean, yeah, not exactly sporty. I mean, even like the 240 SX was hardly like a sports car when it came out, but like, yeah, it was just a, you know, like a standard, like, you know, four cylinder, two door coupe or four door sedan.
Yeah.
That, but people started like club racing in them a lot because they're just like little lightweight cars.
They did have
great suspension.
They did have great suspension. Yeah. I mean, they weren't fast, but they were fairly sporty.
Well, that's what I mean. Like, it wasn't built as a sports car, but like it turned into a great club race car. And then they turned into like, you know,
which by the way,
series.
Today I just learned that wagons came with solid axles instead of independent suspension.
Yep.
So.
Yeah, so the wagon has a solid rear axle.
It's the least sporty one.
Yeah, it is definitely the least sporty, which is great for her.
Yeah, right. And Chris, I'm also going to throw a little correction on you here. Fact check. The 240 SX was totally marketed as like a sporty car. I mean,
ooh,
just like a budget,
got you, dude.
Like a budget sporty car. But I mean, look,
super budget.
But look at like the 1989. It had 200 horsepower turbocharged motor in Japan.
Yeah,
like
but the 300Z was definitely there.
I was gonna say that's calling it Silvia though. You'd call it Silvia a sports car, but maybe
it's
not.
It's an entry level sports. They actually call it like a personal luxury coupe.
Right. Well, you could barely. Ooh, I mean, even
they
like
weren't necessarily cheap.
Like a 240, an S13 240 SX was still kind of sporty, even though only 130, 140 horsepower motor, but. Lightweight rear wheel drive car, like there wasn't much else out at the time.
Yeah. No, I hear what you're saying.
But now we're talking semantics. I'm just really looking for anything.
I didn't know Tim Allen.
I had to do my Tim Allen.
I met Tim Allen.
Did you? Oh, that's right.
Yeah,
he's a cool guy.
That's
cool awesome.
Huge Datsun lover.
So, what if you change your text message tone to Tim Allen grunts and every time you got a text, you're setting next to
him? Needs more power.
Yeah.
So, you actually take Sam's correction?
No, I mean, what I'm doing right now is a bit where because I beat Forsberg at darts and pool, I'm like looking to beat him at other things.
Yeah, I think I was poisoned before those matches.
I mean, you were barely standing because of whatever mysterious substance I was putting in your drinks, such as beer.
You weren't trying to roofie him, right?
Well, I mean, I brought him into the lion's den. I took him to my darts place with my own darts.
Yeah.
And
oh my God, Sam.
And then
he pulled these darts. I'm like, man, these are nice darts for a bar. He's like, these are my darts.
Yeah.
Oh my God.
I was like, oh, I get it.
What a nerd.
And then I took him to the worst pool table in all of Tempe
he knows the
very poorly
of the
balanced.
Table.
Did you brought your own cue stick?
And to be fair,
you probably wear a glove when you play pool too.
Well, it's a power glove, a Nintendo one.
Oh my God.
but to be fair, like you said, it was a 2-hour game, and we did scratch at least, not even exaggerating, 10 to 12 times. It was horrendous.
It was easily my worst game of pool. There were many jukebox breaks in the middle, though.
Yeah.
We were not in any hurry.
Hey, Chris, how does this compare from your being the first guest ever on a Driftcast to this episode? How would you compare the two episodes?
That's a good question, Corey. Thanks for asking.
Oh, yeah.
That wasn't me. That was fucked.
Easily 100 times better. It was the first one was painful. You guys were so excited.
Do you know,
and you would just continue to talk over each other, and then me being on the phone just like, hey guys, I'm still holding.
That was, well, when we first did that first episode with you, it was like, man, who would be a really good first episode to kind of do trial and error with and won't get too bent out of
with.
Yeah, who wouldn't get too pissed off if we fuck up? It's like, okay, let's
like we said on the episode, Chris has often been the test bed for my stupid ideas from driver on driver to other things. It's like, well, Chris is my friend and he doesn't care if we fuck this up. Kind of.
Yeah.
I mean, it's half true.
Yeah, half true. On the back end, Sam, why'd you fuck this up?
Yeah, come on, you idiot.
Making me look like a dummy.
Chris, do you have any breaking lady? Do you have any breaking lady news?
Or breaking lady news?
Late breaking news or anything you want to say before we shut this thing down?
Yeah, I don't know. I mean, we kind of covered a lot of it.
Yeah, we
covered program. Drift Garage is coming back. That's exciting. That's why I'm here.
Hey,
and
we're going to go actually load my car up on a trailer.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I guess now I have to go do manual labor for you, too.
Hey,
why did you just call me?
manual labor.
Before we shut this down, Chris, would you like to select the AAM filter winner from the first month of our program?
You're gonna make me piss off a lot of people.
Well, I'm just gonna put the phone in front of you.
Some
with
of us
a,
have
with
to
a,
lose fans, dude.
With a, I'm gonna put the phone in front of you with a pre-compiled list of the people that shared it.
Share the episode.
Yeah,
well, I had it up a second ago. Hold on.
Before we go there, just quick announcements. Don't forget. So we have our Patreon set up. It's www.patreon.com/.
No, you forgot the HTTP.
HTTP.
/ASL.
www.
That was
you, Forsberg?
Run to the chopper.
I thought that was Paco. Oh my God, that was awesome.
So yeah, you can go on our Patreon. You can help us by pledging $1, $2,
$3 floor.
Somebody. Oh,
yeah. We got to call out. Pull up that dude's name. We got to pull out this troll real quick.
It wasn't really a troll. We actually had a great prize for him for being such a contributor.
Yeah,
right?
So let's explain what happened. So we get a notification when somebody pledges, like, you know, this guy just pledged $1, which, thank you, you know. Somebody pledged $5. Nice, wow, that's awesome. And then when somebody, like, backs out, for example, Sam's mom, went from $3 down to $2, so we're like, oh, well, thank you. Yeah. Well, I can't, so, username...
Mike, Mike Gerenhart. He pledged $50.
Pledged $50.
And so,
sorry, blown out the mics on
it's
that.
Okay. Yep. But what we did is we had actually Chris Forsberg championship winning suit and helmet. We were going to send him.
Yeah, we were so excited that you pledged $50. We're like, this is incredible. We are so thankful. So
we were going to send that to you as a gift. Forsberg a surprise.
Forsberg had a signed racing suit, a signed Stilo helmet,
And a 370Z.
And a 370Z. Yeah. We had loaded it up for you, and we're about to send it to you. And then the next day, you changed your donation from $50 to $2.
So that sounds like a bad mistake made on a Friday night at 2 a.m.
I think he knew what he was doing.
But
we
had a great gift pack for him, and thanks to Chris for supplying everything.
But now instead, as a $2 dude, you're gonna get some stickers, and we're probably gonna write some messages on the back for you. That way, we appreciate every little bit. Of course, even a dollar. If you think this abomination that we call a podcast is worth $1, dude, we would love it. The Facebook app.
You got the list there, Sam?
The Facebook app would not open up the shares for some reason. Mm. And I might actually have to grab my laptop here.
Nope, just click on
share.
Well,
I'm just going to do it.
Paco got it.
I have a real phone. It's a Samsung.
Hopefully it doesn't explode my face. Hey. I tried talking on the other end and blow the side of my face off, actually.
So we're looking for the shared episode.
Let me grab that from you.
Yeah.
In the meantime, Chris, what do you think?
What's your favorite karaoke song?
What are you doing? Ooh, it's been a while since I've done some
it's
karaoke.
It's been a while.
Yeah.
We were supposed to do karaoke last night.
What do you think about neither of you guys came out? So
what do you think about Creed or Nickelback?
I mean, easily the top two bands of all time. So.
In no particular order.
In no particular order. I mean, is it a Tuesday? Like maybe Creed? You know?
Yeah.
So.
True. That's a good point.
I mean, they're solid.
Silent. Yeah, I can only see people who liked it. I can't click on the shares. This is...
That's on the phone. Okay, yeah, we're probably going to have to do... Actually, let's do it like on a live stream. How about that?
No, we'll just do it
after the show.
Yeah,
we have to do it on the computer.
All right. We're idiots right now. But we also have thank our $5 Patreons before we shut it down because so these are the creams of the crops. And these guys have all of our crops are just fully
full of cream,
full of cream right now, and we are gonna read down. Thank you to these dudes. So I want to thank Nate Spinks and Luis Roman, and Scott Davis,
cool,
and Scangage.
Scangage.
Do you want to read? Do you want to read the next few, Chris?
Yeah, I'll get a couple on here.
Hit those.
So Michael Sorkin, nice. Sean De La Cruz, Jeremy Hiles. And let me pass it off to Paco. Read him in Spanish.
Nate the Skinner. Our buddy Momin, who, I mean, dude, like.
Momin sent the care package.
Momin sent us huge pack of candy. Daniel Castrillo. Corey?
Man, I'm going to have a hard time reading these.
It's very small.
Daniel Castillo, where are you at?
There you go.
Right.
Jesus,
there.
Grandpa.
Oh, FRS Anthony, Eric Haku. Manuel Bessette, Tyler Hutchinson, Brian Beck, Mark McCullough, Max Cuddy.
Thank you so much, you guys. These are our $5.
You guys are the real MVPs.
Everyone else that has thrown us a couple bucks here or there, we of course appreciate it. We're going to send out your stuff shortly. And that is a wrap. We're going to go load up my drift car in Forsberg's trailer.
I'm going to have to drive home.
Probably have to put a bunch of air in all the flat tires.
Should we end with the air compressor and the
Compressor, Paco.
All
right, what song are we going to end with?
We should end with the form of the Driftcast maximum Driftcast song that we just wrote
earlier.
This show.
All right, are you going to
lead? Yeah,
that
was a great song.
Yep, yeah.
Go
okay,
ahead,
so I'll start it up.
All right,
do you want the bass flute?
Goodbye to my drift car. You're going with Chris. Goodbye, little baby drift car. I'll see you.
Paco, you ruined it.
Ruined.
You ruined it.
You're blowing it out.
Ruined.